Hello and welcome to Outlander's Guide to Ledaria. This is session 10. Holy crap, we've come so far. There's so much more to do, so much more to see. Let's go. Let's go find our players. Hello. Hi.
Hi.
It's good to have you all here again.
All of us.
All of us.
You.
At the same time.
Wow.
They said it couldn't be done.
For the first time in many moons.
Welcome. How has your week been?
Exhausting.
Oh no.
Agreed.
No.
I am cooked to perfection.
Well, it's a good thing that that this game is relaxing and provides no stress whatsoever to you guys, right?
Agreed.
Okay. Good. Please lie to me.
I mean, I don't even remember what happened last session anymore. I wish someone could tell me.
Oh, if only somebody was prepared.
I'm glad that's not me.
If only somebody would volunteer.
I'll do it. I don't think I really have time to give the recap. I have to drink water for the next several minutes. But I do know someone who would be happy to recap it for us.
Oh, fine, if I must.
All right.
Okay, well, let me go ahead and put the camera on him if we're ready for that.
Sure.
Okay. This is exciting.
I'm so excited.
Video one, that means there are more videos than one.
Yeah, this is actually the first video ever made.
This is where it all started.
I mean, this is pretty new technology for Ledaria, so... Yeah.
Do you need me to pause the music, or...
If it's quiet, I think it's fine.
Is this volume good?
Maybe.
Oh,
what you know once we hear
it's subjective.
Okay.
We are always very well prepared for these.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, we're professionals.
Are we ready?
Yes.
All right, here we go. If it's too quiet, let me know and I'll try and make things better. But we'll see.
It's me, Squeak. It's not my full name, but it's a whole lot easier for your humanoid goo mouths to say. You've probably been wondering, what's our handsome little rat doing following these crazy adventurers around? Well, Granny thought that Pip would need some help getting around. Basically, it's my job to keep Pip safe and make sure that he can speak to other people he needs to. So far, it's worked out all right. But I think Talix might be catching on to the fact that I'm not actually a rat. Anyway, I guess I should fill you in on where we are and what we're doing right now. After we went through the slumbering cave and met the Lady of the Land, we buried the body of Jamuel Fleetfoot and his floofy canine companion and started traveling southward. There, we entered Cleon and met a few very interesting people, like Boovin. He was a hoot to talk to. While at Cleon, we heard about strange mechanical creatures to the west, where a bunch of phantoms like Brooke were gathering. And Tekka heard from a gnome about having extremely lucid dreams while sleeping under a tree near the elven colony, also to the west. With these things in mind, we began our journey west to the next city, one called Vera. On our journey, we came across several plants and creatures, a traveling magpie fond of trading shiny things like dresses, glass castles, and snow globes. And we also saw snake-like plant tendrils that threatened to kill us in our sleep, or blue-bellied four-armed primates called Ugrin, and an Aarakocra male bird who registered a couple of us for the World Point Delivery Service. Oh, and don't let me forget, an enormous white dragon in the sky. Whew. While on the way to Vera, however, we met with the most horrible, disgusting creature of them all. Gnomes. These ratty bastards had captured an injured redbeak in a cage and threatened to use it as a lesson against the Etara who had attacked them. Furious about this, Tekka and Pip approached the gnomes to try and convince them to either give them the bird so that they could heal its injuries or at the very least put it out of its misery. Instead, the gnomes, in typical gnome fashion, decided to be stupid, evil little pig-faced scoundrels, and they stole our money and threatened us with their guns. Pip, having heard the bird's cries, put the bird out of its misery as they were leaving the scene. Poor little Pip was so torn up about this, but he was comforted by the others that night as they relayed their advice for help and their own stories of woe. Pontifex spoke of his childhood bullies who wrapped him in vinegar-soaked cloth. He revealed his burn scars across his weird, slimy skin. And when they finally arrived in Vera, the first thing they noticed was the ancient dragon across the city. They learned that it was trying to research and learn the language of the native Ledarian dragons. At this point, the party split up. Talik stayed at the church, maybe? Not sure. Pip and Pontifex went shopping for rocks and found someone selling a pearl that Pontifex really wanted. Enough so that he was thinking of trading in his new shiny sequin dress at ye olde pawn shop for enough money to purchase it. While in the market, they heard from a band of awful, garbage, pea-brained, warmongering gnomes that said one of their rifles had been stolen. And they said that the firearms cannot be held by anyone but gnomes, by decree of Grand Emperor Radix Bilwar. Radix, he's not even worthy of bearing the rat name. Meanwhile, Tekka and Brooke sought out work for the Phantoms. They crossed a river and saw that there were several Aetarans being watched by guards at the river. And then they found the purple and red symbol they were looking for that signified work for the Phantoms. They learned from the caller that strange gemstone-encrusted wolves were stealing livestock from the farms nearby. Then Tekka asked what the fuss by the river was about. And the person replied that the local Ezin physician had passed away and that the Aetarans took the body, but he wasn't sure about any more details than that. Okay, I think that covers just about everything. If you're still confused, let me introduce you to something called a VOD. Just go and watch the last episodes, they're really good. I watch them when I'm going to bed at night. Yeah. All right, that's it. F you, dragon. Bye.
That is a powerful rat.
Amazing! Well done, Squeak!
Yeah. Well done, Squeak. Yeah, thank you, Squeak.
Good thing that Squeak was here.
I can't clap and push to talk at the same time.
All right, I finished drinking all of my water. We good?
Oh, yeah, welcome back.
Yeah. We're good.
I didn't know you were a ventriloquist.
Okay.
That was so good.
Yeah, that was awesome.
I would give you an inspiration for that, and I will, because the inspiration I currently have is not from a summary. So you can have
Squeak's inspiration.
Yeah, Squeak.
Squeak's inspiration.
Fine. There you go.
It can only be used by Squeak.
Okay. Here is the colony.
Also, Talix might notice the distinct lack of inspiration dies on half of the table.
Oh, yeah. Was that all for the gnome encounter?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was worth it.
It was panicking.
Okay. So, Jason,
nice
you...
town.
I know, right?
Yeah, I think we talked for like 10 minutes about how great the architectural style is.
Yeah, I remember talking about the tall roofs.
You know, guys, there's gonna come a point where I will run out of, like, house models, and I will start to have, like, repeats, and then the magic will be gone.
No, just you just have to make, yeah.
Yeah, correct, I just have to model my own houses, yes. Yeah. For every colony.
Every time we find a new colony, this giddy joy that we all feel, and then we talk for 20 minutes about the architecture, it'll all be gone. And we'll say, hey, look, it's Cleon B.
Oh no!
Gotta keep that budget up.
This way is the south, so it's where you guys have come from. While you were away, Jason, we have indeed decided that Talix probably went to check out the church, but like he doesn't have to be.
Alright, well, sure. Tell me a bit about it.
Okay, because in that case, this would have happened while Pip and Pontifex were at the market, and they heard the gnome talking about things, and they found a pearl that Pontifex is interested in, while Tech and Brook are in the northwestern side of town talking to one farmer. So yes, simultaneously, Talix, you would have gone to check out the church. It is basically right at the entrance of the colony in the direction you guys came from. Like, as soon as you got in, you all ran past it because you immediately went to check out the dragon. But it was right there on your right. Unlike the one in Cleon that was dedicated to, like, pretty much the entire pantheon simultaneously, including also gods from other religions, this one is very visibly focused on the lion. You can see this from the outside, and
I don't think that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. Talix. Everybody as a group went to check out the dragon. Yeah.
Yeah, Talix definitely wanted to see the dragon.
And it's when you split up that like you could have gone just back to the church if you had any interest. So you can see from the outside that it's a temple of the lion. And through the open doors as you like take a peek inside, it's very obvious. The followers of the lion pursue among other things, they pursue beauty and glamour, and the temples of the lion are no exception. You can see that this church was built and decorated to very carefully thread the thin line between pride and vanity. Just ostentatious enough to be worthy of a god, but not quite to the point of just being merely like flaunting its wealth. As you step inside, you admire the stained glass windows, the emeralds that make up the eyes of the large lion statue in the back, and the reflective and highly decorated floor tiles that you're stepping on. There's one corner of the building facing... I wonder if I can draw on it? It's this corner. So, like, on the left compared to the entrance and in the back. That is, and it's high up near the ceiling. It's made up of a single massive corner window that is currently open, and it leads straight toward the what is called the wooden nest, the area where the dragon is in. You can see that from like its angle and from its height, it basically allows the dragon to peek inside of the church whenever he desires. There's a few people inside the building, but there is no like there's no event currently going on. There's just a few people praying. You can see the priestess far in the back, a human woman wearing these very, very bright, very sparkly golden robes.
And I'm wearing dirty commoner clothes. Okay.
Would you like to change it before you go in?
I don't have a...
You have your robes, right?
I have a stole that I can throw around. No, it's literally just like the scarf type thing, the stole. I don't have I don't have a full change of clothes.
Okay.
Not formal wear anyways.
Right. The priestess is well dressed, but the people inside are just the commoners.
Well, Talix will just... I don't think he's going to stop and admire the architecture too much. He's going to, like, glance around, get a feel for it, then just kind of walk up and just try to be, like... focused on business here. But yeah, he'll approach the... You said there was a female priest?
Mm-hmm.
What was... Human?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I'll talk to her.
Okay,
walk up to her.
She's going to, as you approach, and she notices that like somebody's coming up to specifically to her, not just like towards the lion statue to pray. She does lift her gaze from. She seemed busy up writing on a piece of parchment. She just lifts her face and sees you approaching.
Hello, Talix Moyer. I was wondering if maybe you needed any assistance here. Oh, I'm a cleric of Akhenoth.
When you say this, sir, her curiosity is clearly piqued. She stands up, just brushes her robes slightly, offers you a handshake, and says, "Sarah Beth, good to meet you." And then as she looks at you, I don't know what this is. She has kind of really intense stare, and she closes her eyes for a moment and just takes this deep breath. And when she opens her eyes again, she smiles, and you just get this feeling. Actually, roll an insight check.
Okay. Is that again for me? Oh. Higher than I thought it was for some reason. Okay.
It's wisdom.
Sorry, it's been a while. 14.
Okay. You get this weird sense like she knows you in some kind of way. Like she knows who you are or what you are about. She gives you this big smile and says, "Ah, yes. I can see you are indeed touched by the divines. We can always use the help of somebody like you. Did you just arrive in Vera?"
Yes, that's correct. Normally I work around Daria, but I don't often make my way over here. But, anything, any folks in need of healing, or any mission you need done for the sake of your town, or for the sake of the church, I'm happy to help.
What kind of services can you provide besides healing?
I suppose you could say I'm traveling with a band of adventurers. We have some experience. Though, if there's anything troubling the town, we can sort it out.
If you're the traveling kind, I don't suppose you have any experience in dealing with the... And she seems to like look for the right word, and then she sort of like grates her teeth and says, "Locals?"
You're speaking of the Ledarian people here, I imagine.
Yeah.
The Aitara?
Indeed.
Well, sure, I have quite a bit of experience with them. I speak their language. I've done a lot of translation work for the church. If you need to establish communication, I'm one of the best, actually. Not if I can say so.
Good. Then I could indeed use your help. And, she looks around, just kind of getting a feel for, like, who is around in the church. But then she speaks freely to you. She puts a hand on her hip, and you can see that as you kind of, like, follow her movement, you notice that she has this large curved sword that she carries on her hip, and you're not entirely sure if it's, like, for show or if she can actually use it. Although it may not be entirely unusual for a priest to carry a weapon, but like in the case of the priests of the lion, it could just be like another way of like showing their strength and their pride.
So yeah, I was gonna ask, do I know that this is a thing specifically for priests of the lion?
It can be. It also applies to the priests of the owl bear and sometimes the panther.
All right.
There is an issue I am currently dealing with that perhaps you might just be qualified to help me with.
Certainly. We do need... not to be so straight to the point here, but... I was hoping that my companions and I could maybe get some food prepared for our travels. I have some funds waiting for me in Aria, but one of the main reasons we were looking for work here is trying to help us get there, make the next leg of the journey, you know?
Absolutely. You will be compensated in food if you so desire. We do also have money.
Well, either's good, as long as it's fair.
Let me catch you up to bring you up to speed. And she gestures. There's a few chairs like on the altar, kind of in the back. And she gestures for them so you can sit down if you'd like.
Will do.
There are two healers in Vera. One is myself. I use magic for that. And one is the more, the non-magical kind of doctor. Or rather, was. We lost her a couple of days ago, Anezin, by the name of Pax. Thing is, the circumstances of her death are unclear. It appears that from one minute to the next, she was simply dead. And I wasn't entirely sure what to think of it, but her body has been taken by some Aitara filly that I've stopped in town a few days ago, and they have refused to give her back. I will say in all honesty, Talix, that I suspect foul play.
It is rather unusual.
I intend to perform an autopsy on her body, but I can't do that until the Aitara filly return it. And I have no intention of simply taking it forcefully from them. I don't really look forward to souring the relationship with the people of Ledaria, but the more time passes, the harder the autopsy will be. And I'm not going to let them leave with the body. So if you could perhaps convince them to hand it over, that would solve
the issue. I'd certainly love to speak with them and try to sort this whole thing out. DM, is there any chance Talix is aware of any sort of customs of the Ledarians for after death that might give me some insight into why this has happened?
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, roll a religion. Roll a... excuse me, roll a religion check.
Okay.
While he's rolling, what is an Atari Feely? I haven't heard of that kind of Atari before.
Yeah, I don't think we put that in the book, did we? Or did you?
It is not in the book yet. Mm-mm. Well, that will depend on your character. So if Talix also wants to roll, and for in this case it's going to be either history or nature, like your pick.
You've already told me that Talix knows of the Atara Philly.
He does?
You gave me a list of things separately, if you remember, like before.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, he's encountered the Atara Philly.
Yeah, that works. Yeah, thank you for reminding me. That's right.
So yeah.
Okay. So your religion check was 13.
Yeah.
So the Atarophili, and yeah, Talix knows this. I forgot like the extent of his knowledge. One moment. Here we go. They are known for being all the Atara people are somewhat nomadic. They tend to like travel across the peninsula. But the Atarophili are kind of a specific case where they do build settlements, but they basically keep traveling from one to the other. And they're constantly moving because their main source of food and resources in general are very specific kinds of fish, and they basically follow their migration. The Atarophili can be easily distinguished from other Atara because they have webbed hands and feet, and their skin is very pale and slightly translucent, so you can kind of see that when they're standing directly under the sunlight. And as for the religion check, specifically in the case of Ezin, For the Atara, they follow bureau procedures very similar to the ones you are used to. A body is considered sacred and should be handled as little as possible and just prepared to be buried in specific places. They have their own their own version of cemeteries. For the Ezin, you know, in addition to this, that Ezin must absolutely never be touched in any way. With other races, the body should be prepared for burial, and they usually get like dressed in good clothes and such. And Ezin should never be touched.
You know, now that I think about it, there's a good chance I won't be able to convince them to allow an autopsy to happen, but perhaps I can at least get some insight into what happened in the first place. Well, of course, I'll do everything I can do.
I'll get to
the bottom of this one way or the other.
If you could figure out some... If you could bring me some evidence that... Now, I don't mean to accuse anyone of anything, but I am a little suspicious of the fact that they will not return the body to us. So if you could prove to me that the Zitara have not indeed murdered our local doctor, then the matter would be sufficiently cleared for me.
Okay. Well, we will investigate.
If you were to clear up the matter for me, or return the body to me, you would be fully compensated, you and the people you're with. But for yourself, as a fellow priest, you can always find a warm meal here.
Huh. Well, it's very much appreciated.
It's nothing.
I trust I won't have to rely on your generosity for long, but tonight I might take you up on the offer. We'll see.
She right, just gives you a nod. I'm counting on you.
Yes, I will. I'll get to the bottom of this with haste.
She gives you a nod and returns to writing her letter.
All right, I head on out.
Okay. And this is just right about the time when Brooke and Tekka were returning in quite a haste to the market area, as they had heard this loud thundering noise coming from the very heart of the colony. And Talix, you hear this sound too, right as you're leaving. And when you get here, you almost bump into a group of gnomes that are currently leaving right in the direction you just came from, leaving on this side of the market. Pip and Pontifex are like in the process of approaching this building, and Tech and Brooke have just entered the market from this side, so you can kind of all like see each other simultaneously. And you can take all it right. from here.
I'll just kind of like look at the situation and run over to them.
We would definitely hurry as well, seeing as we just heard the shot. Mm-hmm.
I think Tekka would like rush over to a passerby. What? What's the explosion?
Where are the drugs? Swear to me!
The man that you approached just like takes a step back seeing you, and he just like points at a group of gnomes that is currently leaving.
Did they shoot at you? What was that? Did someone get shot?
No, it was a together attention or something.
It didn't have anything to do with, you know, the other day.
I don't believe so. They seemed to have misplaced one of their firearms and seemed to be blaming someone else for it.
I look at Pip for a bit and like squint my eyes.
Okay. Pip points at the air and goes.
Does he or does Squeak go psh?
Pip does.
All right. I'll wave the other two.
Beckon them over. You can see a person moving away from Deka really quickly.
I'll just wave them more rapidly. He's gonna get into trouble, isn't he?
I think we should
split up in this town.
I think we should move on.
Fine. At least they are safe.
Okay, is everyone here okay?
Nothing really happened. They just fired the thing straight into the air.
Well,
I think it was just more of an attention measure. Yeah, they're not the most noticeable type of people, if you get my meaning.
Huh.
Why do they require your attention?
They seem to have misplaced one of their firearms and are blaming thievery. And are saying if the thief is to return it, then no punishment will be given. But if they do not return it with post haste, then they will be punished by death or some such. Whatever. It's gnomes being gnomes.
As far as I understand, death is the only option from the gnomes' creed. They take their guns pretty seriously.
If they so willingly fire, perhaps it's safer in other hands.
Pip nods.
Well. Until
someone who isn't a gnome can figure out how to build them, I guess. But, it did, in a way, do a lot of good. The gnomes might not be here at all if it weren't for, well, their inventiveness.
That would be true.
That would be a bad thing, Brooke.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks for pointing that out, Alex.
So, are you all free? There is much information to share.
Yeah, I found some work.
I came across a thing in the market I would wish to pursue, but I'm a little short on funds. I was directed to this building. Apparently, they will buy just about anything, and you can set it on lien. So I thought to use this building to get some temporary funds to buy the piece, and then perhaps I could use it to make more money in the town.
Yeah, sign above the entrance.
This isn't some kind of scam, is it?
It seems a little bit shisty. Who names a building the Dragon's Horde? It's a little on the nose.
Well, we also got some information about a job potentially bringing in at least 100 gold.
By the way, there is an armed gnome standing in front of this particular building.
Oh no!
Oh, sorry, didn't have to see that. Your minuscule stature.
Oh, forgive him. Sorry. Oh.
You could use my boot like a carriage.
Talix just pulls his whole head into his shirt.
So yeah, how much money do you need?
I believe it was, he's trying to recall to the moment, like literally 30 seconds ago. Was it 125?
I think it was just 120.
I have down 120.
Okay, 120, cool.
120?
It is 125 gold. I appraised it myself. The price is surprisingly fair.
Huh. And what do you plan on, I don't know, giving away to get that money in this building?
Oh, and he'll, like, you know, shuffle through his little side satchel and pull out, like, a corner of the cloth of that sequined dress that we know is magical, but we don't know what it does.
Well?
This has some arcane value, and this is well made. It's a little showy.
Are you sure you should sell... Sorry.
No, it's all.
Are you sure you should sell something that you don't even know its true value?
Well, that is the use I have for the 120 gold purchase. And if the vendor over there is to be believed, this is not a permanent sale. You can simply loan it to this place. They give you a sum of money for it, and then you are free to return and buy it back.
Well, I suppose if you can come back and look more into it after you have the means, you'd know if it was worthwhile. Ah, this feels so...
Even did I make the trade and I get the purchase from the merchant over there, I could actually tell you exactly what it does.
All right, just be aware there. If you give them any idea that you'd make a profit off of it, Oh.
Subtlety is my middle name.
Oh. All right.
He says, still standing in front of the gnome.
I recognize this gnome.
You have not seen this gnome before. She's just bracing her rifle and watching closely at all of you, squinting a little bit in distrust.
Wait, so do they also sell things in there that other people have given them?
It would make sense. Wouldn't make sense for them to buy pieces from people, not for resale.
They must be really cheap. I wonder if they've got used books. Let's go.
There's only one way to find out. We go.
As they go in. I address the gnome. Good afternoon, sir. Pleasure to see you. Very nice day.
Subtlety is our middle name.
Yeah, she, do any of you speak gnomish?
Oh, female?
Yes!
Yeah. I missed that. Good afternoon, ma'am.
I thought you did it on purpose.
I'm an anthropologist of sorts. You could say a studier of the people of this land. Hello, sir. I study Ledarian people. I don't know jack about shit with learned people.
Oh, she just grumbles something under her breath and lets you in.
Pip does that thing where, like, you point two fingers at your own eye and then point at the other person. Does that to them?
That was a different campaign, Austin.
Okay. Alright, you step inside, having very obviously made a new enemy on the way in. There is another armed guard. This is a tall orc that's watching the other side of the entrance, and you walk past him, and the amount of objects in this room is overwhelming. There's shelves and tables that are covered in all sorts of objects of all sizes and make, roughly sorted by type and purpose. And at first glance, most of it feels like junk, but the longer you look around, the more trinkets you spot that admittedly you do kinda want to buy. Behind the counter sits a pudgy dragonborn. His golden scales are glistening in the brightly lit room. He calls out to you, "Welcome to the Dragon Horde. Are you here to buy, sell, or pawn?"
Perhaps a little bit of all three. Just of note, I still have Detect Magic going.
Yeah, I guess you would. 10 minutes, yeah.
Is there just like a quick, like, cursory glance around, I guess. Is this place like dripping with magic items, or is there like, you know, one in every pile kind of thing?
Yeah, there's three sources of magic that you can feel in the room, and a few more in a different room. There is a door in the back behind the counter, and you can feel the presence of other magical things in there.
Okay.
Are you, like, aiming straight for the magical things?
No, maybe it's, like, if there's one, like, that's easy to catch a glimpse of, I'm trying to gauge, are these people aware, like, that these things are magical, and are they price-jacked accordingly?
Yes, you can see something that, is just a small golden bell. Small enough that you could, like, you could put it on like a cat's collar. That's how small it is. It's almost like marble sized.
Sure.
But you can feel evocation magic coming from it. And sure enough, it is tiny, tiny, tiny marble of gold. It has a price in the hundreds of gold pieces.
Judging from your wares, you are aware of what you have. This makes things easier. I have a piece I was wanting to get appraised, you could say.
And Dragonborn gestures for you to approach.
He will slap the thing on the table.
Mm-hmm. And you can see the Dragonborn just almost as if he's appraising you, just glancing at you up and down, looking what you're wearing, looking at your bluish skin. But he doesn't say anything, but you can feel like you're being like he's trying to understand the kind of person you are. He nods, and you put down the robes on the counter?
Yeah, the sequined robes.
Okay. From beneath the counter, he pulls out a long white feather, and he taps the feather on the robes. Then he puts away the feather, And you can sense that the feather is magical. It's one of the items in here that was. Then he begins to very carefully just unfold the robes, and he's going to spend like a few minutes just looking them over. What's the rest of the group doing?
Rocks.
Okay.
Books. Books. Well, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know my interests, right?
I will take an investigation roll from Pip, one from Talis. What are Brooke and Tekka doing?
I don't think I would necessarily look for something. I would rather wait for the others to be finished.
Yeah. I think Tekka steps outside and takes guard. Just looks around the town square.
Next to the gnome?
Yeah.
You two are just going to glare at each other the entire time.
For sure.
What was Brooke doing?
I don't think he's looking for something and rather just waiting. For the others to be finished.
Okay. You watch Pip and Talix just dig around in this pile of assorted things. Pip, your search in the end brings as a result no rocks worthy of your attention.
The store sucks.
Talix, you do come across two books. One is particularly big, but also seems to have a few pages missing. It looks like it's been read many, many, many times, and some pages are just straight up falling off, and some are like you can see that there's a space in the seam where they should be, but they're long gone. This book is it's very old, but written in Plurnan, and it is. It's not this one. Hold on, there it is. It's an autobiography of a very well-known, a very renowned paladin of the past. The second one. Hold on, just getting to that. Okay. The second one is a fictional story that is about actually, roll me a history check. It's about a pirate and his adventures at sea. This one also written in Plurnan, but being in a far better condition and just straight up more newer than the other one you found. Okay, and I said the book is fictional, but like this is one of those figures in history that is like thought to perhaps have existed, or in some form or another, someone kind of like this pirate might have existed, but like the story is for the most part fictional, or like it's exaggerated from. This person may or may not have existed, so,
is but this pirate a goblin by any chance?
I don't know.
Yes.
The Breaking Tide?
It's a Wait, goblin really? Pirate.
Can we just make it? Sure, that's what my headcanon will be anyways. This is about the Breaking Tide.
At least in this book, it is a goblin. Some versions of the story have the goblin be the pirate be a human. It depends on like who wrote it and in what time in history.
All right. Talix looks in his pockets just to confirm that he has basically no money. But what are the prices?
The old book about the paladin costs 30 gold pieces. And Oof. The story about the goblin pirate costs 12.
For some light reading. Okay, I guess Talix will just kind of like set them down and like give a big smile to the Dragonborn as he tries to like vanish among his companions, and he tries to exit the shop without drawing attention.
He's just straight up leaving.
As you're passing by the exit, you come across a similarly disappointed Pip, who also follows you out.
Pontifex and Brook are the only ones left inside, and Pontifex, at the end of his appraisal.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay. The Dragonborn is going to fold the robes back, and he does it it's like a very quick and very practiced motion. Like he gets it right in a matter of seconds. Better folded than they were when you bought them, Pontifex, or traded for them, rather. And he nods, and he says, "For these, I could easily... Well, are you planning on selling them, or are you planning on just loaning them to me?"
That brings up a question. There is a piece in the market I'm interested in, of course, and they were not the type to do... trades, which is more common practice where I'm from, so this is all a little new to me. They directed me to your establishment and said that I could leave a piece here for gold value, and I would be allowed to repurchase it from you later. What is the markup on that?
For every day that you leave an item with me, you'll have to pay me 2 coppers.
Two coppers per day as interest?
Mm-hmm.
Oh! And what would be your assessment?
For these, and he like taps his hand on the robes, I could give you 150 gold pieces.
He's trying to hide his excitement. I don't know. I'll have to consult with my expert on these things. Hold on, I know a guy.
The Dragonborn glances at Brook. As everybody outside is having a stirring context with the gnome, Pip, you can hear your name being called.
Well, Pip wonders if he's in trouble, and he looks back in.
Pip, I have need of your expert opinion.
He waddles on inward.
This fine gentleman here is proposing a 150 gold pricing for my sukund magical robes.
Mm-hmm.
150 shiny one.
Mm-hmm.
Does this seem an appropriate price?
He looks to the Dragonborn. He's never seen one of those before. He's kind of intimidated.
Yeah, this person looks like just a dragon that's standing on 2 legs, and it's like he's made of gold.
Oh, this is precisely why Pontifex called you in, because we talked about Pontifex mentioned people that are part dragon back where he's from, and Piff was enamored with the idea. So he has called you in here under the pretext of you being his expert.
After he stares for a few seconds at the Dragonborn.
As he sees this child just staring up at him, this Dragonborn is like large in all dimensions, but like... He leans forward a little bit and just very gently extends an arm towards Pip, and like it's basically his version of a handshake, although I'm not sure if Pip would understand that he's offering his claw to him, and he says, "Well, hello there. My name is Klamdikatrik, but you can call me Tooth and Nail."
I think Pip would flinch a little bit as the claw is extended down towards him. But then would slowly extend his hand upwards and just sort of like grasp his thumb, which is probably as big as his hand.
Mm-hmm.
What was that name?
Clumky. Hold on. Clumky that tricks. Nope. Hold on. I nailed it on the first read, and now I'm messing up. Clumky that trick.
Oh, it's okay. I thought it was all one word.
It is.
Clumkedetric.
Clumkedetric, okay.
AKA tooth and nail?
Is that tooth and nail in Draconic?
Yes, yes, you understand. Or more specifically, it's literally fang and claw. But like, it's okay. The Draconic equivalent of the idiom of like fighting for something with tooth and nail, you know?
Sure.
Cool. So Pip would put grip his hand around his thumb, and then I guess give it a little shake, and then then let go, and still like a little bit perplexed and enamored, looking at this gold shimmering dragon. Like, how much is this dragon worth? Is he literally made of money? Like. That's a weird thing to think about, I think. And then would look back to Pontifex and... I think I need to make like an insight check here to see what Pontifex wants me to say in regards to his question.
And as it's taking a while for Pip to actually even say anything, Tooth and Nail just chuckles a little bit and addresses Pontifex and says, He's a little shy, isn't he?
He is an eccentric little one. His socialization is a little new to him, but he's good at what he does.
And what does he do? He appraises items?
He advises me on all of the important decisions I make as of late.
Well, perhaps one day I will hire him as my assistant. And he just like gives
perhaps his one day.
Billowing laugh.
I'll let you know, he is not cheap.
With that 20, you can gather Pontifex is literally wanting absolutely nothing from you. He just wanted to bring you in here to show you this person without saying, hey, get a look at this freak. He didn't want to offend anybody. And to kind of, this is more of him giving a learning experience for Pip. On how bartering works in the real world so that you can get your own rocks one day.
Oh.
He's trying to be the old man showing the young blood how it's done back in his day.
Pip just gives you a thumbs up then. Seems like a good price.
This seems
Pip
like
has
it
no
is
concept
Pip approved.
Of money.
I believe you have a deal, my friend.
Okay.
Just to make sure I'm understanding, I can repurchase this item at a price of 150 gold plus an additional 2 copper pieces per day?
That is correct. We're going to establish a time limit beyond which usually I do 3 months. If you don't come back by then, the item belongs to me. But if you come back before then, you can either buy it or extend the time of the loan.
It seems amicable. And this piece will not be up for sale for other people whilst I am away, yes? It is reserved for those 3 months?
Mm-hmm. Not unless, yes, after the 3 months are up, I will indeed attempt to resale it.
Your sales practices do not follow your namesake. I was expecting this to be a little more... for lack of a better word, and he'll say the word for like bloodthirsty and draconic.
Actually, he laughs too, and he says, "Would you like me to raise the price?"
Pip shakes his head. No.
This seems my expert is against that idea. I think we'll go ahead.
I can charge you more per day.
No, I think that your business practices are I believe that you get more return business this way. I assure you that I will be back later, and you'll have my standing recommendation.
Okay, so he's going to... He takes out this... it's like a... It's a notebook. a parchment notebook. And he writes on it. When he rips off the paper, there's like another copy beneath that has exactly the same things he wrote on. And he hands you one copy. And it has a brief description of the robes, a number, and... did you introduce yourself? I don't think you introduced yourself, right?
Mm-mm.
Okay, he'll ask for your name, and then he'll write it down.
I am Pontifex Vas Dalus Al Enoch.
And then he'll ask you to spell it.
it's P O.
And then at the end of that process. When he hands you the paper, he tells you, do not lose this. If you lose this, I cannot give you your item back.
Is my detect magic picking up anything on this?
On the paper?
Yeah. The one that he's giving me, specifically.
Your detect magic would be gone by now, but you would have felt magic from beneath the counter, right? If this was on the counter, so yes, actually, you would have felt magic from this notebook before.
Can I insight check him real quick?
Yeah.
On that, don't lose this, or you can't have your item back.
Mm-hmm.
To see how maybe, perhaps temporary, this piece of paper might be.
Wow.
Let me add that to the counter.
Okay. Well, he seems to mean it. Like, the way he says it, it's like he's used to just saying this all the time. He's basically going through the normal words. It's his normal process of doing business.
No, kind of using this like a shiesty detector to say, if you lose this, you can't have your item back, and this piece of paper might be conveniently enchanted to just so happen to disappear.
Mm.
Okay, cool. Yeah, then if he's given like a receipt, like a bill of purchase, Pontifex is enamored with the idea.
Okay, and you're on that 20, right? You're not really feeling like the impression you got from this guy, especially with the way he handled the pip. Like, it seems like he's used to this kind of attention, and he's used to handling children, and you haven't really gotten a bad vibe from him in any way.
Oh, he has a heart of gold too. I love this person.
As he hands you the paper, he says, in addition to the paper itself, I will I also provide a code word. You'll have to return the paper and tell me the password. So write it down if you must, but I recommend that you just memorize it.
Of course.
Your password is going to be Spring Sugar. Spring Sugar. Is there anything else I can do for you?
No, I believe that is it for me, but I have some friends outside that may want to take a look around and do some more business. This has been a wonderful experience. Merchants of the world can learn a thing or two from you.
He counts the gold coins. He asks if you'd rather have platinum.
Sure, it is a large lump of this sum is going towards one place, so...
He'll hand you 15 platinum pieces.
Pip, okay. Like, squints down at this transaction and is immediately confused. Like, like that you could compact so much currency value into just like 15 coins.
I guess while we're here, maybe Pontifex will say, hey, for your generosity, your expertise, Pip, did you see anything to your liking?
Pip's brow furrows and he shakes his head sadly.
Oh, that is okay. He's very particular, you understand. But I will recommend you to my companions. Thank you again. You have a great day. I hope to see you soon.
Sorry, I was drinking water.
He will give, I guess he'll extend his hand in the, you may have my claw, same type of style.
you two basically hold your index fingers together.
Oh, cute. Pinky promise.
Yeah.
And then Pontifex will give a big happy smile and go to leave.
Brooke would follow them outside.
There's probably a whole slew of stuff in there that he would be more than interested in, but I don't want to get sidetracked and lose sight of the objective. That pearl.
Was Tekka waiting outside the whole time?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think Talik sort of talked to him a bit about the mission he got while we were waiting.
Okay, yeah, let's have that conversation between you two.
Okay. Well, I mean, Talix will just kind of walk outside through the doors. Good evening. Nod to the gnome. Tekka. I wanted to maybe, well, there's been a bit of an issue in town regarding some of the local Ledarian peoples. That's what the mission is, was given to me by the church.
Brooks seems... and I have seen that ourselves.
Well, I don't know all the details. I've only gotten one side of the story, but apparently they're suspecting that some Hytara here have murdered the local Ezin. I find that unlikely myself, but, well, it's up to us to prove one way or the other. So I don't think anyone else is going to give them a fair shake. I'd really appreciate if you helped me with this. And of course we're getting paid.
I don't see how I can help. The guards here hold them hostage.
Well, the first thing we need to do is communicate with the suspects themselves, as it were. Or any local ITAR affiliate maybe has some idea of what's going on. Get the other side of the story, you know?
I fear you have been led astray from the start.
How do you mean?
You call them suspects.
They're suspected by the guards. That's all I meant. I'm not making any assumptions, Tekka. That's why I want you to help.
Then we will
hear them. They trust you more than they would trust me.
Without guards. Let them speak freely.
Well, let's find some locals.
Good. There are many problems here, Talix. Be on guard. Things are not well. Unstable.
You mean this town?
Could go further. But yes.
I'm sorry, can you tell me more about what you know? What's going on?
Well, I feel Brooke should be here. He was given an assignment as a phantom.
To do with the Atara Philly?
No. But something is not right, Talix. They could be related.
Oh, Brooke!
Right around this time, the rest of the group finally comes back out and may continue.
Yeah? Talix?
Well, just to recap real quick on what I told Tekka. Blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm. Well, if we can discuss this somewhere where not that many people are listening.
The gnome is glaring at your group.
It's not that we have any issue with you. Sorry, it's just... Okay, have a good evening. Alright. Well, where would you like to go?
Well, we can go towards the bridge, I guess. I'm not sure. Were there less people around here?
Well, if you were to, to be right outside of the town, there wouldn't really be anyone at this hour of the day in that area. The same would apply over here, past the church, where you came from.
Don't you think this looks a little more suspicious?
This is also where we found the... or where we saw the guards, right? Or was it on this side of the river?
The guards were over here. This is where the Itara family are. And so the guards are in this area.
Well, you can see it from the other side. Yeah, we should cross the bridge. Can't be more suspicious than we already are.
Can I have a perception check from everyone as you go through the market again? Alright. As you are approaching the bridge, Tekka is the one who catches a glimpse of something shiny on one of the rooftops, specifically this building over here. And sure enough, this is something that you have never seen before, but you have heard of somewhat recently. There is a small bird made of metal at the very top of this rooftop, and with the setting sun making the whole area just be like dimly lit, you still catch like a little bit of reflections of the light off of the metal, and that's how you noticed that it was up there.
Slow down. Turn to your right and up.
Oh, what am I looking for here, Tekka?
Light.
Oh! Yeah. And Pontifex is gonna like open the book, the journal, and flip to the page where Jamiel mentioned it and like point to. It is the metal bird, the thing that Jamiel spoke of.
Is it Pepper looking at us?
You glance up, and it appears to be the head is turned away from you, so it's facing towards the river.
You think we're being followed by the same bird, or there's just one in every town where there are gnomes?
Where did Jamiel's journal say that he saw it last time? Was it in Cleon?
It was in Cleon, yeah.
I'm not sure.
We could always simply ask.
Ask the bird?
Ask the gnome or the bird. Either way, I am open to both. Nothing ventured, nothing gained.
Pip, by any chance do your powers extend to metal animals?
Well, I mean, I guess there's no harm in trying. Hey, are you a bird? Can you understand bird? Tweet, tweet.
You try a few different calls, and you actually get a few replies from other birds in the area, and you attract a little bit of like attention from various kinds of birds, but the metallic one never... the metallic one doesn't reply.
After finishing like 12 different bird dialects, Pip looks like a Disney princess with all these birds around him, but the metal bird does not care.
That's a no.
I'd like to observe it for a while. I mean, it's clearly not alive, but it seems very lifelike.
Yeah, you see it twitching. It turns its head on the other side. Does a little hop to turn around. Is now looking to the east.
This must be some... Well, Professor, do you know anything about this sort of magic?
The sort of magic to animate these things? Do I? Or can I check yourself?
Yes. This can be a history check.
Okay. Wait, we might have already done this.
I didn't.
Okay.
Nope. Yeah, you're just aware of like the common conception that gnomes generally tend to be the ones that are capable of like building machines. It's not like it's a skill that can be learned by anyone, but it tends to be very prevalent in the gnomish country. But as for like what actually goes into it and like how much is magic and how much is mechanical, it's not your it's not what you've studied.
I have more of a focus on the more primal aspects of magic. This newfangled mechanical stuff is a little beyond me. I just know it is gnome adjacent.
Yeah, a lot of their stuff is so mysterious.
Given a chance, of course, I would be more than willing to dissect it and learn of its making, but...
I mean, on the face of it, it seems like it must be some kind of spy, right?
I was about to say.
Or some way for the gnome to act as a sort of a local watcher guide. That unfortunate group that we encountered did say that they were there to protect us, help us from the Aitarava. Sure, their motives were less than forthcoming, but that seems to be the facade under which they work, so perhaps these birds are ways of keeping an eye on the comings and goings of the local town.
Maybe they're looking for who took the gun.
That would make sense. Plus, you know, a bird's eye view is probably a better point of perspective than knee level.
But why would they look for that in Cleon, assuming that this might be the same bird?
As you guys are talking, the bird takes flight and lands on this building. And now it's looking to the south.
But we're going that direction anyways, right?
I thought we were going across this bridge.
Wait, didn't you just say here?
It's on this building, yes.
Yeah.
It's on this building, but it's facing the south. This. Mm-hmm. So it's not facing down the bridge.
You know, it's facing in the direction that the water flows. West.
Oh yeah, but I meant direction of the bird, not direction of where it's facing.
All right. Well, let's just... Look, whatever we need to talk about, let's talk about it.
All right.
Yeah, sure. I need to go see a woman about a piece of jewelry. I will be right... And Pornfax will go and make the exchange.
You're buying the pearl for 120?
Yeah, 120 okay. Gold for the pearl.
Yeah, she still has it. She's still willing to sell it for that price. And she'll ask if you got the money from the dragon sword like she recommended.
Yes, he's a... I was very surprised with him. He's a wonderful person. I did not expect it from a merchant. No offense. He was just very pliable, very accommodating. You could learn a thing from him. He would be a great teacher.
Oh my god.
He's saying happily. but yes, if in the event that I require more expensive pieces of jewelry, which given my profession is likely, perhaps I will return here.
Is it the character trait of Pontifex that every interaction with a woman just has to, like, go poorly?
I mean, I guess. He doesn't have
Why
a lot of...
Why limit it to women?
I don't know. Maybe he's just all the bad encounters with NPCs have all been women. It's not my fault.
What did this
all
woman
the ones
do
who
to
are
you?
Less than courteous to him.
What did she do to you?
And she didn't let me even hold the pearl. You were expecting me to buy a piece from a stall that's 120 gold? You won't even let me hold it?
Poor Hallgortrude.
Whatever. Hallgortrude needs to go learn from Fang and Claw, Fang and Talon, or whatever it is.
I take you out to dinner. You won't even let me hold your pearl.
Jeez. but yes, I thank you for your business. It was a great recommendation, and like I said, in the future, if I require more expensive jewelry and I am in the zone, I know just where to go. And all things considering, your pricing was extremely fair, exorbitantly so. Most of you merchant types are shiesty fucks, but no, he didn't say that. Yeah, he doesn't say that. It comments again, I think, for like the fourth time to her face about how good her prices are. And then makes his purchase and tries to leave.
Okay, yeah. She doesn't even get a single word in.
Actually, before I go, do you do like a custom jewelry creation? Is there any way you could like hang this pearl from like a cord of some sort?
She looks at you up and down, she says... No.
Yes, I thought this much. Thank you!
I was waiting for the hard no, yeah.
As Pontifex returns, Tekka says to the group, there is much to do. It is not for us to capture this bird. Waves enclose this duckling, rinsing clean their signs of life.
So I think what Tekka's trying to say is we need to investigate into this matter with the Itara filly. Tekka, and like...
Right? Thank you for translating. All I heard was, I am just so cool.
Just as a heads up, Telix, there is a chance that even talking to the Aetara, they won't tell us anything because they don't trust us either.
Well,
just beware of that fact. Besides that, I agree, we should look into that.
That's eventually. Why we need to be clear that we're sympathetic to them, right? Put my hand on Tekka's shoulder. Smile awkwardly.
Tekka just gives a glare. It's Alex.
Just remove my hand.
Well, we can eventually take care of that. There is another quest I have received that Winteka was with me. Keeps it on the low, since I don't know how much they want it to be spread to other people. Because otherwise they could have just asked the self-proclaimed protectors to take care of that problem. But they instead chose to ask the phantoms. So here you go. Well, I'll share this information with you guys. Please try to not spread it too much unless we need to. Apparently, around this area where they keep livestock, there is some kind of a wolf coming and taking the livestock one by one, like every evening, every other evening from then, and that is more or less endangering their own livelihood. It doesn't seem to be a normal wolf. It seems to be a pretty big beast with... And he tries to think of the explanation. With some rubies coming out of their fur, and their teeth are supposedly gemstones. I have never heard of a creature like that.
So that's why this is urgency, then?
Not really.
Oh.
But it is a problem. It endangers the people that want to live here, and it pays quite well.
Will
Is
the job to kill the wolf?
They didn't say. Well, Winsor, did they say kill, or did they just
get the red up there?
Yeah.
Okay. If it is a job such as this that would pay so well, I would expect they want the corpse of a gemstone wolf in exchange. But they would prefer not to take that action if unnecessary. We have a local wolf speaker, of course.
That's why I was thinking that bringing Pip into this could be very helpful.
Pip and Alex, don't forget his abilities. He has calmed the most ferocious of beasts.
That is true. Then Pip and Alex. Okay. They can talk to the wolf and see if it works that way. Or at least make sure that they don't keep eating the livelihood of these people.
It might not be that easy.
I agree.
When was the last attack?
You know, the sun is setting and you guys had agreed to meet again at sunset. And you're like right there.
Meet?
Yeah, if you want me to, I can bring you to them and you can ask the questions yourself.
Okay.
Just be friendly to them. Don't be too harsh on them, even if they want this wolf gone.
How long do you think this will take? Brooke, I appreciate the urgency of your mission as well, but...
I haven't accepted it yet.
There were strong implications that if the matter with the Aitarafili is not resolved quickly, the guards or the church might resort to force.
Why would the church do that?
Forcibly taking the body of the Essence, that's what she said.
I mean...
The Aitarafili have taken the body of the local doctor, the Essence?
Oh, yes. Sorry, I thought we went over that whenever you came out of the store.
maybe
I probably rushed the details.
How long, roughly, do we have before it's no longer considered sunset?
Well, the sun is still in the process of setting, so it's not, like, fully dark outside yet. Probably by the time it's too dark to actually get anywhere.
Alright, well, yeah, let's meet with these people if we need to meet with them, and... I guess
I mean, if you're really against it, I can just go there by myself, tell them that I'm currently busy.
We should help them, but...
You could also... Well, I'll talk to them. You could go to the Aitara and talk to them, try to get something out of them. I'm pretty sure I won't be too helpful with that in the first place.
Not to make the decision more difficult, but if my studies are
to be correct, I believe wolves are most active at dusk and dawn. So I would assume if these gemstone wolves are adjacent to the Plurnan variety, perhaps we might encounter them on the way.
Possibly.
Do not take it for granted they are wolves.
Yes, of course.
Also, just for our just for the sake of it being fair, they offered 100 gold, and we can, if we should kill that wolf, we can obviously keep all the gemstones we want and see that as proper payment.
I see. I currently have a lean out. That could be most valuable. Oh, speaking of this piece I bought, and he'll pull out that pearl. I assume this is like a nice pearl. Given the value. If any of you have come into possession of any magical pieces, but you are unaware of their full capabilities or enchantments, with this I can tell you.
We don't have time. The sun is setting.
Sure, it is just something to keep in mind.
Behold.
So, Brooks said he did end up saying that he would take the gemstones off of the wolf.
If we ended up killing it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I make an insight check on Brooke?
Sure.
Alright. Basically, Talix is beginning to suspect that you're... Why did that happen? That you're turning to poaching, basically, and that you're kind of hungry to...
What do I roll?
I don't know.
I mean, rather than rolling, just to tell Jason what you feel that Talix with a 16 might get from like that particular line of thought.
I guess you would get the feeling that he is a man who would do his job as a job and nothing else.
Hmm. All right. Well, let's go meet with the farmers, and we'll figure out our priorities from there. Taka, is this okay?
Yes. Brooke.
Yeah.
When a phantom accepts a task, must they resolve it?
It sounded like they're paying me in advance. We could probably make a deal that we don't get some money before it and see what result we're coming back with and then get paid based on that. That's probably possible. But usually when you get paid for something, you should... Well, you have to do your task.
I see.
That's... sensible. All right, let's meet with them. Which way?
This way.
Are you sure you know your directions, Brooke? I know this isn't.
I'm so sure that I'm going backwards.
You may have to offer him some guidance.
I can.
Yeah, you follow Brooke.
All right, I will give him guidance if we're actually doing a roll.
No, you're not doing it. It's like still, okay. This is still part of the village. Like there's just the further away you go from like the heart of Vera, the more you just find like the occasional farm here and there with like lots of space in between them. But you're really not far from the river at all. You're just going like just a few minutes up. All
right.
And are you okay, Austin?
Yeah.
And you said I was fidgety.
It was following your cursor earlier. Dennis was waiting on you to notice, but you never saw that we were holding hands. All right. So you go back towards the building where we were earlier, and you can see that there is a group of people that's like gathered in front of it. It's 8 men and women. all talking to one another in kind of like hushed tones, and you immediately recognize Kraith and the man you talked to earlier. That is, and he's among them. And as you guys approach, one of the women in the group gasps loudly and points her finger at Tekka and says, "Vin was right. You have been dealing with a demon." And Kraith immediately replies, "Oh, come on, Liana. We chameleons know better than to judge people from their race."
"That's no race. Don't you know? His parents don't look like that. There is no tiefling lineage. He's cursed. And he's going to curse everyone else here, too."
And I keep on bickering. Some in a bit more hushed tones, but like you guys get like most of it. And the woman is making like no effort to hide this from you guys. She's very openly hostile.
All right, I will go forward to Crave and say, "Hello, nice to meet you again."
Hi, evening. I got everyone who had any information on the wolf.
Yeah, about that. Just as a heads up, if you disrespect my comrades, I'm not willing to do any of the jobs for you, and you can deal with the wolf yourself.
Well, the
woman, yeah. She speaks up. "Well, I have no intention of giving my money towards a demon."
Well,
like you said, that, like, then all of them have like their own amount of money, sort of like their own little pouches. But Kraith like tries to hold up a hand, so sort of like we're pushing her back with an arm, and says, she doesn't speak for all of us."
"Well, is she part of your group?"
They all glance at one another, and she just says,
"Well, I suppose not anymore. Not going to deal with a tiefling, but this demon shows up in our colony, and my kids go missing at the same time, and you call that a coincidence?"
And she just, like, holds up her chin and turns around and walks off.
As she's almost out the door, she is suddenly pushed by some strange force.
Well, there is no door. She was just like walking away from like the whole thing. But yeah, what?
She still here. Somehow runs into a door.
Yeah, what's how are you holding her back?
I'm not holding her back. More pushing her out quicker.
More shoving 5 feet.
Okay, yeah. She seems to, like, pick up speed. And fumbles a little bit, but then
it
continues.
Just glares in her direction.
"Why you bully me?"
And, Kraith looks like he's just very nervously sort of, like, rubbing his beard. And he says, I'm really sorry. Though I guess that 100 gold pieces is now going to be 90 between the 7 of us.
Give me 1 second, and I'll turn back to the group. "Do you still want to do this, or did that change your mind?"
If these people are in danger, this one person's bigotry should not endanger the whole community.
They are not responsible for behavior of others.
All right. And I'll turn back around. All right. 90 gold. That's fine by me. Just as a heads up, if it's possible, since we don't exactly know what we're dealing with yet, I would like to do some sort of deal, if that is okay.
What were you thinking of?
Well... obviously, with a situation like this, and so much vague information, there is no guarantee that we will be able to fulfill the mission, right? Well, I'm willing to try. There is a chance that we might not be able to. So, I understand if you don't want to pay in advance, there's a chance of failure is there. So, I would suggest that you give us part of the payment before and part of the payment afterwards, and we will report back once we're done with the mission.
Half before and half after, that would be fine with me. And like he turns back, and they just the rest of them quickly discuss this and that they all confirm that they're fine with it.
Okay.
And they begin to like pour all their money together and they count 45 gold coins and Kraith is the one who like hands you those 45 and holds on to the rest. And he says, well, you had more questions, right? We'll try our best to answer them.
Yep. Number one, Telix, could you do me a favor and take out your sketching book? Paper, pen?
Sure.
If one of you guys could describe one of the creatures, you could try to sketch what you get from that. That would be already very helpful.
Okay, there's going to be two people in this group who are like specifically gonna go to Talix and offer their own description of the wolf that they seem to have seen.
The other questions I would have is I would need all the information on where you have seen the wolf coming from exactly, if there have been multiple ways, where you've seen him leave, if there is like certain times it always arrives, certain times it leaves, if it takes like more than one animal at a time, or like as much detail as possible so we can potentially find out a pattern if this wolf has one.
Okay. So, to Talix, they describe a white wolf with particularly a fluffy fur, but completely white and with kind of ears that are a bit longer than the wolves of Plurna. The rubies that I have said are like embedded in its fur. They are almost all of them collected like around the neck area. On top and on the sides and a little bit beneath the head too, but they're mostly collected in that area and on the at the very top of the back along the spine. They describe red eyes, red fangs, and red claws, and like ultimately at the end of that description you have like something that feels like perhaps it might have been exaggerated a little bit on the side of making it look like almost just very, very fiendish. But they did seem pretty consistent, the two of them, between their descriptions.
And how good of a look did you get at this thing? How close were you?
One of them says, well, I've seen it from just no more than 15 feet away. I had my lantern lit, I shine my light on it, I know what I've seen.
And you?
The other person, a bit less forceful, a bit less, or at least doesn't show the same amount of certainty, but he still claims to have seen it from about 40 feet away.
And nighttime both times?
One of them a nighttime and one of them more towards the sunset with still a little bit of light in the sky, but still kind of dim.
And had it gotten into your pastures? It was eating your... I don't know if it was sheep or whatever. Is it their cows?
Yeah, one describes the wolf as having taken a chicken and run off with it. And the other one says that he spotted the wolf early enough that he didn't seem to be taking anything. He just ran off.
Hmm. Alright. Your chicken, I suppose it was in a house, or was it in just an open fenced area?
This one is actually within view of you, it's sort of like points, and it is an open fenced area.
How high is the fence?
High enough for it's about person height. Like an adult human, 5 or 6 feet up.
That's probably pretty big then. Okay.
Meanwhile, Brooke was asking questions about the time when the wolf has been spotted, or wolves, and the direction, right?
Mm-hmm. Basically, just if there's like a pattern, potentially.
So the wolves,
when he arrives, where he goes.
They have been spotted always in the evening as the sun is setting or after it has set. Or if they haven't been seen, the animals disappeared at some point during the night. Like they noticed that something was missing the following morning. They all say that they've heard howling from the west. So they're all pretty convinced, and the one that saw the wolf running off, the two of them, sorry, that saw the wolf running off, they also saw them indeed run off towards the west. They confirmed that their animals have been killed about once or twice per week between all of them. Was there anything else you wanted to ask?
I guess, unless they say anything else towards us, I would try to ask which of... How can I imagine this? Are those like many farmhouses?
Yeah, they're all like very distant between one another.
All right. Which of these farmhouses belongs to said lady?
If you ask them, they'll point to just one that's kind of further away. A bit more to the north, a bit more to the east, kind of very close to the river.
All right. Unless any of you guys have any more questions?
I'm sorry, I might have spaced something. You said the howls came from the west. Is there... What is to the west? Is it a woods, a forest?
It's a forest.
It's a saffron forest.
And their farms are built into the forest, basically,
most of them are very close to the river, and the river just gently slopes. It goes like slightly to the east at the northern end, and almost completely straight south on the opposite end. So most of the farms are not like into the forest that they're saying the house were heard from.
All right.
Did you ever say how big the wolf was?
They'll describe it as being pretty big, about 4 or 5 feet high, about the size that you would expect from a wolf. From a Ledarian wolf.
4 or 5 feet high on all fours.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty big. Okay.
It's freaking big.
Mm-hmm.
All right, shall we do some discussion just amongst us while we try to figure this out?
Yeah. Thanks for all the information. We will try our best, and we will report back as soon as possible.
They all nod. They begin to disperse, but the man that you've been talking to this whole time, Kraith, does, linger a little bit excuse me, he says, I've heard very good things about the phantoms. I have no doubt that you'll put an end to this. And with the money isn't much, but we put together everything we had.
I mean, I understand that, and we accepted the quest so far, so don't worry about spending too little. If what you're saying is true, and this beast shall be slain, then... And it actually has some gemstones, and that will be more than enough.
He nods. Seemed a little bit anxious throughout this entire thing, but on his own, just with you, he does calm down a little, and he does... Like, you do get this feeling that he actually has some respect for your job. Rather than the kind of reaction you're often used to. Perhaps it's just Campbell having more tolerant people than other places, but this guy does seem to actually put his trust in you. And he nods, And he nods to the rest of you. And he, like, his gaze lingers for a moment on Pip. But then he just wishes you a good evening. He makes sure, do you have any more questions for him before he goes?
Not me, at least.
Okay. But he does invite you to come back if like there's anything that comes to mind that you might need, that you may need to ask.
Okay.
All right.
And he
Thank
goes
you.
Inside.
So
Is this a good time for a break?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I am out of water. And so go get the snacks, go get drinks. I'll see you back in
yes.
10 minutes.
Yes, sounds good.
All back right. In a few.
Bye.
Laters.
Bye.
Hello?
No, it's
What's
right
happening?
Chair, for sure.
It's fine. It's fine. Hello.
Hi. What did I interrupt?
It's stricken from the strike for a record. It's fine. It's fine.
Okay. All right. Yep. I will never bring this up
fine.
Again. Welcome back.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Ooh, squishy you. Rat. You guys
hello.
Got your drinks.
Hello, squishy rats.
Yes, hello, squishy rats. That's just what I call my viewers on Twitch now. If you're a fan of WintherMaw, you're a squishy rat.
That's just for today.
It's the greatest compliment I can bestow anyone. we're back. You guys just talked to the farmers and learned some information about the wolves.
The jewels.
Did yes, and
he just had to go and ruin the reveal like that. that's what they're actually called, jewels.
Jewels. And you were about to talk to one, to among yourselves, I believe.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, go right ahead.
Well, I think the first thing Brooke would do. When they are together, by themselves, he would take out like 9 gold pieces each and give it to them.
Oh, how much did we get paid just now?
Half, 45. Oh.
That checks out.
Hey, that mouse checks out.
yeah. But it's striking him as odd that, and the story is the wolf. Well, it was always seemingly just one wolf attacking alone.
That's not
true.
That's not usually how wolves hunt.
Right.
Right.
Not Plurnan wolves, anyway.
I'm trying not to let my knowledge of Plurnan wildlife affect my perceptions too much, but it is very unusual. Did I miss it, or did they mention approximate time of attacks? Are these done in the night? Are they in the middle of the day? They've witnessed the wolves, and they've described the color of the gem, so it could not have been too late.
It was evening, nighttime.
Mm-hmm.
Between the two.
Interesting.
Yeah, as far as I know, it's only ever been seen by a lantern light, and it's only 2 accounts, and one might have influenced the other. I don't know how accurate the description really would be. It might not actually be made of gems, Brooke.
It's a knife. I think there are some unlikely circumstances that could be made, but I feel like it is appropriate to air them out beforehand. In the event that these wolves are not able to be communicated with or are unwilling to cooperate, we are all resolute in that we must deal with the beast appropriately.
I mean,
wish to keep unnecessary killing to a minimum, but is that the agreed upon course of action?
No, not until we understand what's going on.
That's okay. Why I made the deal. Since there is a chance that we can't slash don't want to kill that beast.
We should figure out why it's come this far from the woods.
Right, and there is the issue of everyone seems to be on edge about these wolves, that this is not usual. This is not a common native of Ledaria, from what I could gather. So there is the possibility that these are not natural, that these are man-made, you could say. That there might be...
Or gnome-made.
Right, there could be other forces at work behind them. It is unlikely, but it is a possibility that we should consider.
I like your old thinking. Just keep in mind, if you actually want to do this, there is a chance that this can get very dangerous. And if we like it or not, there is a chance that we might have to kill the beast too.
I don't believe any of us traveled here from Plurna expecting a safe visit. Danger is just part of it. But if it is important that we all know that we are willing to kill if necessary. He's kind of like side-eyeing Pip in between words.
What?
I just know that you have a form of attachment to these things and that it can be traumatizing.
Well, I know that sometimes, you know, some animals need to eat other animals to survive. That's just the way it is. That one time I saw a dog eating a bunny rabbit, and I said stop, and it said it didn't have anything else to eat. So I was like, oh, that's sad. So I gave it a chicken leg. And then I thought about the chicken. Anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. It's hard to escape.
Okay. Yes, that is my only real concerns that I wish to voice is in understanding the implications of the job and to also take into account the possibility that this is less natural than it may at first appear.
Well. All right.
So how do we want to proceed? Do we want to check out the Aitara first? Since you mentioned some kind of urgent as well. I mean, it is sunset, so technically this is prime beast time, right?
Brooke, did you get an account of all of the attacks that we know of? We should try to figure out where the beast tends to hunt most often. We need to know where to look.
Well, we know where it's going. We could check for tracks. Windsor, did you say that you mentioned in one of your descriptions that it sounds fae-like? Right?
What does?
The wolf, like fae or fiend-like?
Oh, the farmers were describing it to sound fiendish, she said, but I don't think it actually meant.
Yeah, because from the description, just the fact that they gave it like, you know, red eyes and claws that are blood-colored and fangs that are red, it could come across as possibly being exaggerated, because it doesn't feel like any kind of animal that you know of. So perhaps I was just describing that Talix might get a feeling that perhaps it's been idea of it is very devilish.
Okay.
Yeah, that's just an impression. Doesn't have to be. I mean, I guess you'll find out for yourselves.
In our first conversation with Kraith, he mentioned that these creatures feed in moments of darkness, and their howls could be heard to the west.
Yeah. That is true.
So, if we wish to approach them, look to the west.
That's true, but it's hard to search the whole of the forest.
Yeah, we have two options, basically. Either we could just go into the forest and take a look, which is kind of difficult. We could wait here, wait to see if it attacks, and, well, just be ready in case it happens.
Pip raises his hand.
Yes.
If they were taking some of the farmer's animals, then they might have left a trail behind.
Yeah, we should investigate the sites of each attack. Good point.
It should make a pretty big mark if they had to drag a whole animal across.
Yeah, that's true.
Alright.
So I'm assuming we're starting straight away? We're not going to the Aitara, because you did say it is
work on that kind of urgent.
Okay.
It's nighttime. No one's going to want to speak to us right now. Alright. Where was the most recent attack?
Okay.
It was like the open chicken coop, right?
Uh-huh.
Well, then I would start walking there.
Okay.
Are there any marks?
So the chickens have like their own little... The coop is the name of like the little building, quote unquote, that they go in, right? Oh.
It's an immense catch.
Yep.
Okay. So like now that it's night, they're all in there, but you can see the entire like fenced off area. If you're looking for evidence of the wolf having been here and the direction he might have gone towards, for most of you, like if you're looking for like footprints or whatever, that would be survival, unless you have like a more specific idea in mind, which might call for a different role. Okay, well, footprints and the like, that will be survival. And
Pip might ask the chickens as well.
Yeah, you can call out to the chickens. And it's you're making chicken noises, so it's not like you're gonna, you're not like yelling. And there's going to be a few chickens that just pop their head out. What are you asking them?
Did you see any really big scary wolves here? Did you see them go back to the woods?
All of you hear the chickens, just all of them starting to like make noises. They're obviously, whoa, it's obviously
one at a time.
Sort of like a in a panicked way as they all say, yes, 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 scary, scary, big, big.
Oh, which way? Which way?
And almost all of the chickens just run out of the coop and they like push up against the fence. And well, they're all on the western side of the fence. That way, that way, that way, that way.
Pip just sort of says to himself,
imagine the things I could do with an army of chickens. People would fear me. Anyway.
Oh my god, it is all birds, huh? I have rolls just for Brooke and Talix, is that right?
So far? Depends on if Tekka had point effects want to look for.
Tekka has a different plan, so I want you to resolve your thing first.
Yeah. Okay. Brooke, you do. You're kind of part of your training gave you certain skills and certain specializations, and to your trained eye, you do easily spot on the fence itself some traces of blood that has been for the most part washed off, but would like is sort of like permanently stained a little bit. And from there, and seeing where the chickens are sort of gathering as Pip is talking to them, you are able to spot a few places here and there, some broken branches, some bushes that have broken leaves that seem to just sort of like lead into the forest, and you can't like tell how far it will go, but you have some generic direction.
Well, we at least got like some kind of clue where to go, and I'll point out the blood and the broken leaves. Sticks to the others.
So this is a trail that goes all the way... How far does this trail go?
Well, Brooke can't tell from just standing here, like, he'd have to actually go.
Oh, okay.
Pip, the chickens are telling you all about the one chicken that has been taken.
Oh no.
Her name was Molly.
Molly?
She was the mother of a lot of other chickens here.
Oh, gods.
They all miss her. They ask if you'll bring her back.
I will do my best. I can't make any promises, but I'll try my best.
What was that guy interested in trying?
Okay, I'm gonna do a roll. So take a at the southernmost farm and heads about 3/3 north until he senses a feeling and then starts walking west towards the edge of the forest.
Okay.
And at the edge, between two trees, he will make a snare trap using some rope.
Okay.
Tech is so cool.
Did you do your own roll for how he's making the trap or for the location of the trap?
That first roll was the location.
Okay.
But what do you want me to roll for now? Is it just how well the trap is?
Generally tying knots and such falls under sleight of hand. But you don't have really any tool proficiencies that would assist with that. Just sleight of hand rule. Unless you have any items that also would help with that, besides, well, the rope itself.
Doesn't matter.
Damn.
Oh.
The second one of the day.
All of a sudden, knots appear out of his staff.
The main thing with a trap like this, like, are you aiming for it to catch the wolf?
Yes, I'm imagining similar to a deer snare trap, which is like, it's like a noose between two trees that is like at head level, and it basically, the noose is hidden behind a bush. So if like they decide to run between the trees, their head will be caught by the noose.
Yeah, and based on the description you've been given of the wolves, this needs to be like something very sturdy, capable of like actually holding like the weight of a really large, very strong creature. So you account for all of that as you build it, and you believe that this should be your knots should be good enough to actually hold back something this big.
Listen, if humans decide to just run through the woods willy-nilly, then, you know, things happen.
That's what happened to the missing children.
Oh, no. And it was set up by a demon.
Yeah, they all got caught in Tekka's traps. The woman's vindicated in the end.
The woman was right.
She was! If a gnome gets caught in a wolf's snare, that's her own shortcoming, and frankly, not our problem.
The gnomes would just lose their hats.
Yeah, shortcoming.
Yes.
Okay. As the rest of you begin to head west, a little distance away, you see where Tekka is currently working and finishes setting something up and seems ready to rejoin with the rest of you.
How dark is it at the moment?
The sun has fully set, so it's completely dark. I need to check the calendar to see what the moons are like right now.
Ooh.
Just so that we're not wandering through the forest in the dark, Pontifex will he'll make a little light.
One of the moons is pretty much full, and the other is for the most part visible. It's still nighttime, but it's even for those of you who cannot see in the dark, you can still see ahead, like in a good 30 feet ahead of you, around you.
I think in any case, Pontifex is still going to make a little blue light, unless someone tells him not to.
Nice. There's a bunch of shuffling and rumbling in Tekka's backpack, so Ollie has awoken and is getting out.
Instant joy.
It's very cute. We should think about where they might strike tonight. Sorry, have we... So I kind of asked Brooke earlier, but it never got answered. Do we have, like, an account of the history of these recent attacks? How frequent they are, where the most recent ones have been, how... where they tend to be?
Yeah, they did say that it usually happens once or twice a week. And they didn't give a time on when the last one was, but I think they pointed at that chicken cage. And besides that, the only information we got is how they looked and where they came from, and that there was howling.
Well, how long ago do you think this attack was? Looking at the remnants here. Yeah.
Yeah, can I make a check for that?
Yeah. Although, a check for what?
How long
for
ago
how
was...
long... Yeah.
Oh, based on the evidence you found?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can. There will be investigation.
Ooh.
Okay. To you, Brooke, the blood couldn't possibly have been shed more than a week ago. Definitely less than 7 days.
It appears to be, or it appears to have attacked once this week.
Well, yeah. Okay.
It can't be more than 7 days ago.
I don't think the blood would be here if it were longer than that, but... Okay.
I mean, if it was up to me, I would either wait for it here, but that could take a long time, or if we're pressed on time, go looking for it.
They don't seem to attack in the same place twice, do they?
From the descriptions you've had from the various farmers, it seems that all of them have suffered at least one loss, but some of them have suffered two or three missing animals.
Yeah, it's fairly spread out.
We could have
bait. It's unusually spread out. It makes them very unpredictable.
I could pretend to be a chicken.
wants a wolf to attack you?
No, you... You...
If we knew, that would work if we knew where they were going to be.
Alright, if waiting is an option, we can go look for them, right?
Well, we have some kind of trail.
Yeah, that's why I said if waiting is an option, we can go look
and keep
the trail. Maybe it leads us somewhere.
Alright, let's see how far this goes.
Alright, I would like to follow the trail.
Okay. While following the trail, I will ask for another survival roll, and this can be done by more than one person, as Brooke points out, the science that he has spotted. So we can do two people, or one with advantage, just anyone who is proficient in survival.
Okay. I'm not proficient at survival.
It can make a roll.
Sure,
I will give Pip guidance.
Oh.
You can make two, Pip.
Oh. Wait, so is it advantage?
No, what? Guidance is a d4.
Okay.
So we said either two of us do it or one with advantage.
Mm-hmm.
Pip can roll with advantage.
Yeah, if there is more than one person who is proficient in survival, then he can roll with advantage.
Okay,
fine. I wanted to give him guidance, but...
And guidance!
Oh boy! Oh boy!
No pressure.
No pressure!
Wow. Let's roll the d4.
No, I shouldn't have been involved. That's what my rolls have been all day.
Oh no!
11.
Wow.
Okay.
I'm on the trail.
Oh God.
Molly.
Oh.
Are you out there, Molly?
Wait, let's have this for the time being.
Ooh, music.
I actually think it's hilarious that chickens give each other human names. Instead of going like, oh!
Barbara! Okay, so you guys are leaving Vera from the west. And at first, you're not too far from the road. If you... Here. The road that leaves Vera goes almost straight west, and you guys are traveling somewhat parallel to it, but more on the... at first you're on the northern side, and then as you're following Pip, who's doing his best to stick to the trail that Brooke originally spotted, there comes a moment where you cross the road and you find yourselves instead on the southern part of the forest compared to the road itself. Here the trees have a bit of a... Some of them have a yellow-golden coloration, both through the bark and their leaves, which you assume is what gives the forest its name. And let me bring this in now. No.
I love this music.
As you have left the road, the forest is quite thick, and there is moments where Pip is like almost forced to abandon the trail just to get around a particularly thick area of vegetation where, especially for him being the smaller one among you, he's actually struggling to push through the bushes and just very tall grass. Despite it being nighttime, this forest has a lot of noise to it. You hear a lot of birds chirping and a lot of bugs. I'm going to need everybody to roll a perception check. I also need your marching order. Pip is in front.
I'll go second.
Pontifex is probably near the middle, just with the light.
Okay. I guess I can go after that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's Pip, Brooke, then?
Another nat 20.
Let's go. Nat 1.
It's okay, you're too busy watching the trail.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
Run it by me
while watching the trail looking for rocks. On the ground.
You never know. Pip, Brooke, and then? The order?
Pontifex, yeah. And Talix.
And Teka, at the end.
I guess.
Yeah.
Pip can't see over the grass.
There's moments where you just straight up like lose sight of Pip, the rest of you. And Pip, you almost have to wade through this vegetation. Like, it actually, it slows you guys down considerably. But having the light from Pontifex does help. And again, there's moments where you have to kind of abandon the trail in order to actually get to a point where you can walk and then try to look for it again. And you think you're that you're still on track, Pip. There's a few moments where you have no idea where you're going, but like I said, this forest is full of animals, and you're able to just ask them if they've seen a creature in the area recently, and you describe the wolf in question, and some of them are able to actually lead you to a spot where you're able to resume the trail, or at least a trail that is just like it.
Mm-hmm. To help Pip sort of see and move along, Pip is holding up Squeak like a periscope, turning him around.
Okay. Yeah, that works. Just so that you can gain a little bit of height. And you can see through his eyes, right?
Yep.
Yep. This and that. Okay. And, Pip, there comes another moment where you're a little worried that you might have gone off track. And so you call out, you can hear a few birds in the area, and you try to call out to them. And, one of them replies that it has seen something like what you're describing, and to approach towards it. That it tells you that it can show you.
I trust it implicitly.
So you take a little bit of a detour again, and as the rest of you can hear Pip just doing a bit of like some kind of bird call, both. Actually, yeah. It's going to be Talix and Brooke and Teka. And Pipnosis. So everybody but Pontifex would be able to recognize that the call you're hearing is that of a hawk.
Pip, any chance it's telling you the number of them?
Let me try and ask.
Pip tries to ask that.
Oh, you didn't go for the hawk screech?
Yeah, pretty good. The number of wolves? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah.
And you guys hear again a hawk call, and Pip, to you that means that this bird has seen one.
Birds can count. It is worth noting.
It's true.
Not all animals are good with counting. Birds, generally, very good with counting.
This isn't the most... Good enough. And as you leave the trail a little bit, it just, well, you don't know where the trail is, but as you go a little bit in a slightly different direction from where you were heading, just to try to find this hawk, both Pontifex and Brooke recognize that something big has been through this area. Just based on like the damage on the branches and the way that the glass is flattened in most of this area. Something that's probably about the size of an old wolf, or even slightly bigger.
Well, I guess we found what we're potentially looking for. Or at least more of a trail of it. Is everyone comfortable with moving on?
Well, now that we have found a tangible trail and we know we're after something, perhaps everyone be a little more on guard.
We should probably approach quietly. Animals can get they can get scared and mean if they're surprised.
This might not be
my best.
It definitely sounds more and more like this creature isn't native to this land. Whether he's actually artificial.
Oh, never mind.
Oh. No, not Plurna. But not native to here, this wood specifically. No pack? That's interesting.
I would like to pull my sword.
Okay.
Just to be ready. Mm-hmm, and then we sneak.
Just keep it out of the light.
Of course.
Talix will don his armor and shield.
Are we wanting Pontifex to kill the light?
Are you sneaking up on the hawk?
No. Just as we follow this trail, if it seems a bit more fresh.
Okay, so you're not approaching the hawk that called for you. You're following the trail.
Yeah, following the trail. Yeah.
Switch to a red light. It's a little better.
Yeah, sure.
Because the hawk did request that you come closer, but like you can just follow the trail instead that Rook and Pontifex spotted. I was just making sure I understood what you were doing.
So we didn't find the new trail because of the hawk. Like, this wasn't what the hawk was talking about?
You haven't seen the hawk yet. The hawk is telling you that if you can come closer, it can help you. But Brooke and Pontifex have spotted their own, like, very large trail.
Okay.
Sorry, that wasn't clear.
I think Pip would relay that, then just say,
the hawk says it could help us if we come a little closer to it. But it would mean leaving this trail.
Is it not in the same direction?
I don't know.
Well, alright. How about some of us wait here and someone escorts Pip over to meet with the hawk and see what comes of it. And then we meet back here before we go any further.
This sneaking business is not necessarily my forte, so perhaps I go with the party that is expecting us.
All right. Pip and Pontifex, just remember your way back here, okay?
My mind like a steel trap.
Actually, in fact, I know what I can do. I'll look around for a leaf or a flower petal or something.
There's plenty. Many are just like as big as the palm of your hand.
All right. I'll whisper a little incantation into it, and I'll hand it to Pontifex. Just keep this with you.
Okay.
I can lead you back here if need be.
Sure. What was it again?
Sorry, yeah, what is it, a flower petal or a leaf?
It's a large leaf.
Okay, big leaf.
Okay.
Yep. Just hold on to it.
He will grasp it in his hand and will hold it.
We slowly trudge through the tall grass.
Yeah, it takes a little bit. You didn't kill the light, right? You have... is it red now?
Yeah.
Okay. You're approaching towards the direction where you heard the hawk calling, which you heard it too, Pontifex. It just like meant nothing to you.
Yeah.
But you push a little bit further into the forest, perhaps about 100 feet away from where the rest of your group is. And then you can hear the hawk again, and to send from above, up on one of the trees directly above you. And Pip, this to you translates to... Hold on. I lost my spot in my notes. Sorry. Okay. This translates to... I can help you find that creature. And you look up and the leaves are like a little bit too thick to really see through, and the light doesn't quite reach between them. But you see the branches bending down a little bit. Yes, more winter birds! Yep, it's night. Pontifex has the light on his staff. And as you see the branches like bending down a little bit, it feels like the weight that is on them is a lot more than you would have expected from a hawk.
Okay. We would really appreciate that.
I also will need a favor from you.
What do you need?
I am quite hungry.
And something massive comes down from the tree. And I need everyone to roll initiative as a winged bear with the beak of a hawk and the wings of a hawk comes down from the tree and jumps on the two of you.
Boobin?
Boobin? Boobin, no!
A good thing we split up the party, right, guys?
Hawk bear!
So, through the grass, the grid doesn't really show, so I might just get rid of it, because it might make things a little too difficult.
I mean... Pontifex and Pip are the only ones there, right?
Yeah. You guys are 100 feet off, away, right? And you did the cantrip thing, right?
So yeah, but I also gave him bad instructions. Okay.
Oh. what would you have told him?
Because I realized I needed to tell it where to go whenever I cast it, and I would have told it my own location. I should have told him to let it go when if we needed.
He was told to hold on. He will hold on to it.
Whoops.
I mean, we can take it back. Talix knows how his own spell works.
Well, maybe you'll just feel it constantly slightly tugging in one direction. And you realize that if you let it go, it will fly off on its own.
Sure, he's pretty intuitive.
Okay.
Okay, here we are.
Sorry.
Oh, this is cool.
So I've got I
haven't set my
grass.
Initiative yet, sorry. Wait, why are there two Talixes?
There's two Talixes?
There's...
Oh, wait, I see one on your side of the table.
Okay, never mind.
Roll for Squeak. Hey, Squeak. Oh crap. Oh, okay, good.
Bonk. Oh crap.
Oh, ew. I had this.
It inflate.
hawk bear.
Obviously, the mini is not going to accurately show this, but
it's
yeah,
like
it has,
an owl bear, but faster.
It has Donde wings.
Donde está los wings? My immersion.
Okay, and the rest of you, being about 100 feet off, let's see, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Yeah, okay, the map is big enough to allow for this weapon, so you're roughly over here. So you can place your minis in this general area.
All right, so did we hear something happen?
Not yet. I'm missing Brooke's initiative.
I put it on the thing.
It says irreverent.
Oh, put it in your. It's under value.
Yeah, initiative value.
And I can't see if you've done it or not because it's like.
Yep, I put it in the modifier. Sorry.
All right.
Should be now.
Okay. Yeah. There we go. Oh.
Hawk bear.
All right. And I need my board. All right. So we begin with the called hawk bear, taking you by surprise and jumping off the tree and taking a swipe at both of you.
Whoa.
Does a 14... What's up?
Can we conveniently say that a giant bear jumping out of the trees would spook Pontifex into letting go of the leaf?
Yes. Yes. Okay. We can.
What? He just tosses the leaf.
What?
Does a 14 hit Pip?
Yeah.
And does a 17 hit Pontifex?
Yeah.
Okay.
You got two dead party members.
I'm so happy right now.
Let's send the two squishiest ones out on there.
So it will bite Pip for 11 piercing damage with its beak, and then swipes at Pontifex with its enormous claws for 15 slashing damage.
Oh my god, Pontifex is almost dead. Wait, Pip is dead, isn't he?
No!
Oh, wait, no, that's Squeak. Okay.
I was wondering why there were two health bars. And this creature seems very much set on eating you. And then we go in initiative for Squeak's turn.
Hey, Pip, look out!
Squeak's going to, I think, try and leap onto the hawk bear.
Okay. I will call it an acrobatics check.
All right. Would it help if Squeak wasn't a rat anymore?
Yeah, it would help.
So, Pontifex, what you would see is mid-leap, the rat suddenly starts to transfigure, and its joints become elongated, and certain body parts change and shift, and a pair of long black wings extends outwards from its back. And actually, Winther, you said that it looks different than what a normal imp would look like.
Its skin is a bluish color.
Ledarian imp. This is just a Ledarian rat. I don't understand.
So in this moment of fear, Squeak transforms into its true form, an imp, and flies over onto the hawk bear. Would I still need to make that check for squeak?
If you can fly, no.
All right.
Is this about the right size?
Where?
Next to Pip.
Yeah.
Okay, let me plop it in here, and then you'll have to adjust its health and such. But oh, okay, that's actually gonna be a lot of work. Let's not deal with that.
I can't
but
even
you can,
see it anyways. It's a failed to load model.
Really? This one?
Oh, yeah. So it's just like a little blue marble looking thing.
What?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's only the people who have previously loaded it are seeing it.
So I think one of the fixes for failed to load objects is throwing it into a bag and then pulling it back out.
Nope.
Failed. Again.
I think it works for you too because you've cached it from loading it before. You might need to re-upload it somewhere. But that can be sometime in the future.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Well, for now, keep using the mini off the map.
I can see it on the stream.
Oh, yeah, because I can see it.
Yeah, so I just popped over to the stream, looked at it. It's very blue.
Very blue, yes. I keep using the mouse for the time being.
Okay.
You were describing it, sorry.
That's fine. So yeah, midair, squeak, the wings erupt out of the back. Its limbs elongate into more like clawed hands and feet. And from the back, there is a spiny, like scorpion tail. This is very much not a rat. And so as Squeak now lands on the hawk bear, it's going to just try and like latch on close to its face and distract it.
Okay, so it's not an attack. You're just trying to get it to
Well, its action was turning back to its true form, so it hasn't used. Yeah, that's its turn.
Okay, it's distracting the hawk bear. All right, moving on to Tekka.
Yeah, do we hear anything?
I'll say you can roll a perception check. All Talix and Tekka and Brook, because
we did get beaked and then slapped.
And Pontifex went, wah!
And there's probably a very loud grunt of pain from my life flashing before my eyes.
Also, I would technically know that the leaf started moving.
Oh, yeah.
Because I was concentrating on it. But I'll go ahead and make the check. Let's see.
Oh my god, okay, none of you have heard.
No!
None of you have
even
heard the commotion?
Even the Pip lookout? Oh no.
Talaxy, at least you know that a leaf has started moving towards you.
So, could I say that I think something is wrong?
Leaf moving towards you could mean that they're just coming back towards you, but it would have been like too early, like they just got there and then they're coming back. I think, yeah, it's fair that you might think that perhaps there's something going on, yeah. So for, it is a Tekka's turn, but like, what would Talix say to the group?
The professor let go of... I wonder why he let go of the leaf.
Do you suspect something wrong?
He might want us to come to him.
Understood. Tekka will do like one big stomp and two small stomps in the ground. And Ollie,
recognized that as his call to come to Tekka. Tekka will pick up Ollie and then start walking towards where he saw them walking, Pontifex. Then,
yeah.
Okay.
I guess Talix will probably do the same. We don't, until we have a reason to know that something else is going on, we'll just walk at like walking speed.
Yeah, exactly.
So we can kind of like perceive more.
Mm-hmm. And Brooke, the same for you?
So I guess dashing would be meta?
A little, yeah.
Alright. Oh. 10, 10, 20. What the? I got stuck in the branches.
Hey, you can go in there.
Brooke is pretty tall. Okay, moving on to Pontifex.
Brooke dashes towards him and gets caught in one of Tekka's new straps.
Oh, no. Pontifex?
Pontifex is gonna bet it all. I need the bear to make a DC 13 wisdom save. As Pontifex is casting command, I think he's just saying, flee! Is telling the bear to flee.
Does command require a shared language? Oh yeah, if he doesn't understand the language, it doesn't affect.
Okay, I guess that won't work. Then I guess he won't bet at all. oh crap.
I could say it for you.
yeah. Okay, then instead, I guess as a bonus action, Pontifex is going to cast Sanctuary on Pip.
Oh.
And then and with my action, he's going to cast Mind Sliver on the bear.
Okay. Mind Sliver, yep. It's a save, right? Intelligence.
Yeah, 14 intelligence save.
Yeah, you have two different DCs.
Mm-hmm.
Right. 12.
It fails. So it's going to take 1d6 psychic damage, and it subtracts 1d4 from the next saving throw it makes before the end of my next turn.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to deal this much.
Four psychic damage.
Nice.
Both of you see that the hawk bear just ever so slightly pulling back a little bit, as if it found some source of pain, perhaps from the imp that's on its face, but then it's just like struggling to get a thing off of his face. Is that everything from Pontifex?
Yeah, it has just a verbal component, so I think he just barks something at it in, you know, arcane mumbo-jumbo draconic, I guess, and just, mm-hmm. like, gives him a brain freeze, basically. Momentary okay. migraine.
Pip!
Squeak, what are you... ow! Professor, run!
Pip is going to use his bonus action to...
Is all this coming from Squeak's mouth?
Yes, so it's very weird. Actually, I don't think Pip would be able to speak at all in this instance. Good point. That's what's going through Pip's mind.
Okay.
Pip cannot speak through Squeak unless Pip is, like, trancing. So, in that case, that's what Pip is thinking. And Pip is going to use his bonus action to try and shove Pontifex away from the bear. This is a saving throw that you can choose to fail.
Yeah, he'll choose to fail.
That pushes you 5 feet away. And Pip is very confused about Squeak's current state, but is going to reach down and grab the doll very quickly and... pull out a needle and look towards the bear and just say, nope, can't say anything. He's going to prick the needle into the forehead of the doll, and he can sort of whisper a few of these arcane words in Infernal, and is going to cast Phantasmal Force on the hawkbear.
With saving throw, right?
Needs to make an intelligence saving throw.
Oh, and you it subtracts a d4 from it.
Saving throws.
Oh.
It subtracts... is it the same as the damage that it took?
No, it just subtracts a d4 from the next saving throw.
Okay, like I'm rolling it. I'm rolling the d4, yeah.
Sure.
Okay. Is this... Okay, it is a d20. So I'm subtracting 2... and then this much. So 12 again? I think again.
Okay, that fails. And so Pip is crafting an illusion in this hawkbear's mind, and I want it to believe that an enormous wall of green fire has placed itself between it and Pip.
It
says 10-foot cube, so yeah, I think I could put it over here, too.
Yep, that works. A wall of fire that's angled at an L.
I guess, like, all around it, right?
It's an L-shaped wall. Or you can put it all around it, yes.
So green fire, just all around it. And then...
Includes sound, temperature, and other stimuli. Stimuli? Yeah. Also evident only to the creature. But like Pontifex doesn't see this.
No, right? No one sees Nobody anything sees except it's, for the hawkbear, which believes it's surrounded by hot, very hot, green, bright fire. which is probably interesting to see from an outside perspective.
The bear just like starts losing it.
Yeah, target can use an action to examine the phantasm with an intelligence investigation check against your spell save DC. Like this is an animal. It is not going to examine the fire. Are you done with your turn?
I do want to move still. Now that he sees that like the bear thinks it's surrounded by fire, Pip is going to start running and wishes that he could yell, but cannot. All right, so. Yeah.
Well, and you do have sanctuary, so if it tries to attack you, it'll have to make another save.
Right. I don't think it would, because, well, it does need to have a sight on you to take an opportunity attack, which I think through fire it would, but it is not going to stick its arm through fire just to get to you. So you can move, and then that's it?
So each round on my turn, the phantasm can deal 1d6 psychic damage to the target if it's within 5 feet of the phantasm.
Mm-hmm.
And it also perceives the damage as a type appropriate to the illusion. So
yeah, it's psychic damage, but it feels like it's burning.
Feels like fire, yeah.
Okay, roll your d6.
Three.
Okay. And then it's the hawkbear's turn, who is indeed going to freak out. This is not Boven! There is nothing owl-like about this. Wow, yeah, okay. This is a terrified animal that is surrounded by fire. And it's going to instinctively just swat at the thing that's in its face so it can get like a better look around. So it's going to attack. It's going to attack Squeak with its claws. That is a 25 to hit.
Yeah, that's almost double his AC.
For 13 slashing damage, that's with the claws.
Okay, that would kill Squeak if he wasn't resistance to. Slashing.
It is indeed slashing. And then since it's on its face, it can't... I'm going to roll a beak attack too, but I'm going to do it at disadvantage. Because it wouldn't be the easiest thing, and I imagine that, like, Squeak is trying to not be in its mouth.
Preferably not.
So disadvantage, it's a natural 2. What is Squeak AC?
13.
Yeah, okay, it's going to miss, definitely. But the Hawkbear does manage to, with like one powerful swipe, to sort of like fling Squeak a few feet back away from it. Which is like fine for Squeak, who can fly. But the Hawkbear, Pip, you can hear the Hawkbear just screeching in terror at the fire that's all around it. And it's like turning around and trying to find a way out, but it's all in every direction. And there's no way out for it. So back to Squeak.
Squeak. Oh boy. Trying to think whether he would stay on the bear.
Yeah, I think now it's Squeak like, might say over here, but like flying up.
Okay, I think Squeak might turn invisible and just sort of stay flying around the bear in enough space to where he could attack if commanded to.
Okay. Tekka, you are within view of Pip, who's running towards you.
Yeah, Pip will definitely start to run then, if seeing. Yeah. So that's 5, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40. Okay.
See, Pip's like holding one of his arms that's like the cloth has been ripped and you can see he's starting to bleed.
Okay.
And you can see a bit further up ahead a large winged bear who is just standing in its paws, sort of like batting its wings, but not really extending them too far. It's like it's trying to fly, but without expanding its wings to its full wingspan. And it's very unclear to you what's happening with that animal.
Yeah. I think Tekka will shout, "Pip! Brook!" And then, run just behind him as far as he can reach up there next to Pontifex.
What's your movement speed?
It's 40, and I dashed.
That's right. Yeah, 40
monks are speedy boys.
Mm-hmm. Speedy boy. Yep.
Okay. Anything else?
Yep. Can't think of anything.
All right, Talix?
Pip is just outside of the range of my dark vision, but I hear that and I will begin to run forward and eventually I'll see what's going on.
Yeah, there is the light from Pontifex's staff, so as you get like close enough you can see the group.
Unfortunately, I still can't quite get to Pip. Even dashing, but I'll dash up in his direction and just call out, "Pip! Pip! Oh, you're hurt! Come here!" And, that's it.
Okay.
For now.
Rook?
I'll guess I'll dash.
Hey, everybody 10? Else has been running.
20. 30. 10. 20.
Are you attempting to move through the poisonous plant?
Poisonous plant? Can I walk through that?
Yeah, you can.
The man-eating flower?
20.
Touch it, you die.
All right, I don't know. I guess this is it. That's my turn.
Pontifex?
Yeah, I guess he's going to, now that the cavalry has arrived, he's going to, yeah, I think he's going to blast this thing with magic. He's going to pull that golden orb thing that he carries around and kind of spin like a, you know, a hologram roulette wheel of sorts until it settles on a fire. And he's going to lob a orb of fire at it because it seems, I don't know, conveniently fitting. Not that he knows.
Not that he knows.
A flat roll. A 14?
14 hits.
Nice, okay.
It's a very large target.
That's going to be, okay, 15 fire damage.
Hmm. Okay. I don't know if you hear this from this bear that has a beak for mouth, just this terrified kind of squawk that is incredibly loud from this. And now the bear is actually on fire.
really helps with the immersion.
Yeah.
Pontifex is going to back away. I think he's backing away, and that is my move. And I think he like backs into Talix, like bumps into him. Maybe this is like the recoil of him flinging that fireball, which he's not. He's not a very throw things athletic type of fellow, so I think it's some recoil and he stumbles backwards into Talix.
Talix just kind of like, oof! Okay, you're safe now, Professor. One second.
Yeah.
Thank you. I seem to have stumbled a little bit.
Pip does move in the rest of the way towards Talix and gets like sort of in this little clump with the rest of them. And
the bear takes damage, yeah?
Yes. So that's another D6 of Fikic. Okay. And Squeak uses Pip's attack action to make a stinger attack.
Okay.
With advantage, because invisible. Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
24 hits.
All right. So that is going to be first 7 points of piercing, and it needs to make a constitution saving throw.
It should be pretty good at those.
Well, my dice disagree. 9.
Oh.
I fail every single save so far. Yes, well, the intelligence ones were rough.
Yeah. Okay, then that's going to be 3d6 poison damage as the stinger of the tail swells up and injects the venom into the hawkbear.
Okay. And as you all hear, it is this enormous part bear, part bird creature yelping in pain. Does Squeak return invisible when he attacks?
Yep.
Okay. You see a small humanoid-like creature, but very, very tiny, with horns and palish blue skin, just digging its tail, into the neck of this bear, who slowly its body becomes more rigid and then just falls forward, and it is dead.
All me. I'm here, I helped.
And Squeak, in imp form, you can see is injured. Like, there's a good gash, I think, like, across his small, frail chest.
Yeah, Tekka will, like, hold out his quarterstaff and, like, halfway. Yeah.
Talix is gonna do the same. He'll put out his stick. 1 second! And I'll just, like, hold it forward and, like, get ready to swat at the thing if it comes close.
Hey, relax, relax, it's me.
Can you see it now?
Nope.
No!
Yeah, it'll have to be hosted somewhere new.
But the link is fine. Like, I can download it and it's not broken.
I caught it on stream, I'm so happy.
Mere mortals cannot comprehend my true appearance. Please forgive
me. Squeak?
Wait. What is this?
It's weird hearing Pip question Squeak through Squeak.
Would I recognize that creature?
Ooh, you can roll a nature check with advantage.
Not religion?
Actually, either will do. You do get advantage on religious ones too, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So you could pick
it's
if you wanted.
It's both the same for me, so...
They're both the same for me, too.
So it's a nature...
Talix will not have advantage on this one.
Can I... Alright, so I can roll.
I thought that was what you were implying.
Ooh. Damn.
Okay. How about now? Can you see it now?
Yeah!
Yeah!
Hey.
Boom! Here you go.
Look at the cute little guy.
It's so small. Okay.
He looks really angry.
He does.
That's my secret. I'm always angry.
Okay. So yeah, both of you would recognize this as something fiendish. Okay, and for both of you, it is based on your knowledge of such things as they are on Plurna, okay? But Talix straight up knows that it is an imp, or at least it looks like an imp, but it's a light blue instead of being red. But for the most part, it matches with what you would otherwise know to be the description of a small kind of devil. Known to... be very much in, I guess we've never explored this, like, out of game, what it means, for, like, fiends to exist in Plurna, they do work kind of like how you would expect, as in they are sort of, like, in, these creatures that are in opposition to pretty much everything that Talix believes in. So Talix is the only one who can, like, actually tell that this is a little different, at least the coloration is. Well, for Brooke, this just matches the description of what you would know to be an imp. And that would be the extent of your knowledge.
Tekka will kind of, like, fasten his grip of Ollie on his shoulder and, like, have kind of his body between Ollie and this imp. Creature? Explain yourself.
Jeez. You reveal yourself to be a devil and then suddenly everyone loses their minds. All right. Look. My name is Squeakashtarax Jr.
I would like for you to update the token appropriately, please.
Okay, let me do that.
That's not your name.
It's a junior.
Just a junior.
Oh, so it's a winter dragon, is it?
here on behalf of Pip's granny as a bit of a translator. If you want Pip to be able to talk to you, then you're gonna need me here. Bottom line. I don't mean any of you any harm.
I'm gonna turn to look at Pip and see what his reaction is.
Pip is wide-eyed right now. You can tell that he's seeing this for the first time. Not like taken aback as in he's scared of Squeak, but more just like a little shocked and curious seeing this form.
Well, Pip, what do you want us to do?
I don't mean to interject, but does something need to be done? I don't understand the problem.
Professor, do you recognize that creature?
Yes, it is fairly obvious. I'm still failing to see the problem.
We'll be in league with devils now. It's all part of your open-minded approach to everything, I suppose.
I thought that we were leaving racial bigotry out of the equation.
I'm mainly asking.
I say it is, rather than judge a person by how they look, we judge them for their actions. I have no reason to doubt Squeak's intentions. Seems to have been a dear friend and companion to Pip. He has never wronged us. He has helped us in our time of aid. When that thing attacked us, Squeak was the first to act. He perhaps saved my life.
I am mainly asking because Pip looks like he is seeing this for the first time as well. And you said, it is his companion.
Because he felt the need to hide its nature.
Judging by your reactions, I wonder why.
Gotcha there.
Is that Squeak? Yeah. Laughing at saying that?
Professor, surely I don't need to explain to you the way devils operate, their deals.
Yes,
sure, I'm sure he's affording Pip powers that he finds useful, but there's always a catch.
Of course, but if my studies are to be relied upon, which I tend to do, this is a devil, it is not a demon. And devils... Yeah. Seem to operate based on contracts, and they tend to honor them.
They operate to their own benefits, at the expense of others.
Well, it doesn't sound like he is contracted to Pip, but to Pip's grandmother. And I'm sure that whatever price she is paying, she is willingly doing so in the interest of Pip's safety.
Yeah, Squeak. What's up, Ticker?
Will you continue protecting them?
Of course. I mean, look at me. I just took a claw to the chest protecting them.
Fine. That is all I need. And Ticker withdraws his quarterstaff.
I understand the misgivings, the hesitation, and I do not expect you to not harbor suspicions. I'm sure that Squeak, having revealed his form, is aware of the consequences and the impact it could have on your outlook, but I say that until he has done anything to prove otherwise, he is the same companion he always was. Is that a fair analysis?
I think that should be Pip's decision, and not ours.
Coming back at the town with... Have you believed that our friend Tekka is a devil as well?
I mean, there it was our decision, right? But as you said yourself, this is Pip's companion. That's why I asked what he thinks of that, and about his opinion.
Well... First of all, they actually called Tekka a demon, and there are vast differences between the two. I am a devil. I am not a demon. That's kind of racist to say so, if I don't do say so myself.
Literally no one said you were a demon.
This is exactly what I was saying before, is that demons are the ones to not be trustworthy of. I was speaking to your credence.
Yes, thank you. I know. Anyway.
Then Pip. Pip's voice comes out of Squeak instead.
Well, Granny did tell me that he was an imp from the start, but I didn't really know what that was. So now I do.
And this is fine by you?
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't really know what you guys mean when you say that he's a devil, but he's helped me get this far.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Yeah,
I understand just... this is a difficult pill to swallow, Talix, as a person of your faith, but I believe there are times in life where you must make a concession.
I'm going to kneel down at the corpse of this bear and examine it.
Roll? What are you trying to learn? About how it died? Or
okay, first of all, have I ever seen a creature like this?
Ooh, I'd let you roll a nature check.
Okay. Well, let me just tell you everything then.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also wanting to try to discern how it died, basically.
That will be
what did Squeak do?
Mm-hmm.
Alright. So I rolled checks for each thing?
Yep.
Okay, here's nature. Nice, natural one. Balance things back out. Needed that.
While you wouldn't know if, while you've never seen or heard of a creature like this, the fact that you have absolutely no idea of something like this existing probably hints at the fact that there is no such thing in Plurna. You can't be too sure of it, but you expect that you'd know if you did.
Yeah, not much. Yeah.
And a 15 is sufficient to be able to tell that it seems to have... the rest of the damage was all psychic, right? Like, the only damage it has ever taken was from the mind sliver and from the poison and from the phantasmal force. Is that right?
Pontifex did burn it with actual
fire.
He
You're
did
right.
literally throw a fireball and then recoil into Talix's
yeah.
arms.
So
I'm mostly just focusing on the wound that Squeak...
Mm-hmm.
I saw Squeak attack it and then it die, but
yep.
I want to see if I can figure out...
And the fire is obvious enough for anyone. It's just this large patch of burnt fur. But where you saw Squeak just push its scorpion-like tail in its neck... You can feel with your hands that all the muscles are just very tense, especially in that area. And the very rigid way it has died all seems to hint at some kind of poison, like a very powerful mm-hmm. snake bite.
Talix will wordlessly just take out his book and begin writing and sketching.
Mm-hmm. There is a... foaming at the mouth, and its eyes are just open and way wider than they should. Well, mouth, beak.
Hey, look, I know that this is a little shocking to some of you, but as long as none of you call me a demon, I think that we're gonna be on great terms. Just think of me as the good old rat that you've always known.
and then just sort of morphs into Squeak again, the rat.
You really wanted me to say the "that is a demon" line, didn't you?
So we good?
Squeak, I do not understand you. That does not mean I do not accept you. Thank you for protecting them.
Yeah, right back at you.
I have no qualms with this development. In fact, I am a bit of a pariah when it comes to people of this type of thing, but I am, for one, a little excited about a new unknown venture. I could perhaps bombard you with hours upon hours of questions. I've never had the opportunity to actually speak on friendly terms with a devil.
Oh, yeah. I don't want that.
Yes, well, perhaps a trust-building exercise for another time. Perhaps if we knew more about you, people would be more accepting of you. People fear what they do not understand.
That does not help.
It would help me.
In any case, before all your questioning, we should tend to your injuries. What did this beast do?
Oh, don't mind me. Pip got the worst of it. I can handle myself.
I'll put away my book and pen. Unless Tech is about to do something?
Nothing in particular.
Oh, I thought. Okay.
Pip just moves his hand and arm to the side, and you can see that across Pip's, like, arm, shoulder, and chest, there's a large scratch mark.
All right. Yeah, wherever the worst of it is, I'll just lay on my hands and... Oh yeah, you know how my cure wounds works, so I'll just cast that.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Talix.
You better see how well it works before you thank me. Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, you can thank me.
Oh, poor Jason. Don't mention. He's no longer trusting your roles.
Oh, hey, it's full.
Yep.
Yeah, besides the damage to the actual clothes, and the blood that seeped into them, there is no more sign of the injury having been there in the first place. Pontifex is also healing himself?
Yeah, he's. Whenever the others are kind of tending to Pip, he's gonna kind of turn around to not make a much of a scene of it, and is just healing, wording himself, just kind of a little bit of light healing, mending. I feel like he got slapped with the claw, right? With like the big fist of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm thinking it just like
maybe Pip was one who was bitten actually.
Yeah, Pip was one who was bit.
I don't think either of us were bitten. I think we both got clawed.
No,
you got beaked.
Oh, never mind.
Yeah.
Pontifex got hit by the claw. I don't know if it cut him or not, but I was picturing it as it just straight up bashing the chest plate and, like, I don't know, breaking a rib or something.
Mm-hmm.
So he's just, mending his rib and whatever bruising and kind of helping himself a little bit.
Professor, help approach him. Do you need my help?
No, I will be fine. This is perhaps not the last encounter we'll have. We're planning to have more. If we encounter the wolf or the Atira, you might have need of your magic. I will just be more careful.
I have some to spare.
If I'm not one to turn down someone who insists, but just make sure that you prioritize our future safety. Dealing with them now can have lasting consequences.
Professor, if something happens to you, well, it's not a very good future for me, is it? I'll put my hand on his chest and cast Cure Wounds.
Yes, exactly like that. Conservation of magic, perfectly done.
Okay, maybe I'm a bit more spent than I realized.
Well, it's hard to get through the chest plate.
Is Squeak back into rat form?
Yes.
Then I would probably walk up, take out a bandage. Well, I can't really heal you. But unless that really bothers you, I can at least bandage you up so it doesn't get infected.
Oh yeah. Well, here, do it as...
Just kind of turns back into
it. You hear like the bones cracking.
On top of Pip's head.
You do it right here. It'll stick better.
All right. I'll start bandaging the wounds.
Yeah, your bandage is very oversized for a Squeak, so you're sort of like wrapping the entirety of his body from beneath his shoulders to like the part where the legs begin. Wrapping him entirely.
Yes. I mean, if it is actually way too big, I can probably rip it into half.
Yeah, you fumble with it a little bit. You cut it long ways, so it's overall thinner. And you make sure to wrap the bandage around so that, like you said, it would help with like it not getting infected.
And Pip's clothes were like torn up from it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think after Pontifex gets helped a little bit by Italics, he'll say,
"Well, I can." I can address it for you. It's no problem at all.
Do you sew, Professor?
It's a mundane term for it, which...
And he'll pull out two lodestone, two little dark metal magnets. And will, like, pinch the tear and, like, run the magnets across it. like, pinch it between the magnets and make it, like, a crease.
Pip, and add them as the magnet goes by.
Seals it.
How much?
Repairs the clock.
For these? It is not really like a price kind of thing. These aren't very uncommon. It's less about the object and more about the arcane knowledge to use them.
Okay.
And over the course of the next minute, Ip's clothes are going to be put back together.
What?
The gash is gone.
Yeah, he'll just keep creasing these things between these magnets, and it's just kind of magically sealing them back together good as new.
Whoa.
Verbatim, leaving no trace of the former damage.
It says some blood.
Yeah.
I'm working on a spell for the blood.
I've decided to abandon this primal magic mumbo jumbo and pursue hemocraft.
Okay.
Brooke, you wouldn't know anything about that, would you?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Just to further cement myself as no one from either side of the arcane spectrum or divine spectrum likes me, I'm going into blood magic next.
Oh, buddy, you're in for a ride.
Okay. So as the group is all huddled around Pip, the Pontifex fixing his clothes, Brooke bandaging up Squeak, Talix has taken note of where he's catching the bear, or Squeak, or both?
For now, just the bear.
Mm-hmm.
And Talix will finally kind of try to change the subject a little bit. It was an animal that I lied to you, Pip. Very intelligent. Had used your own ability to lure you. I don't think any animal on Plurna has that capability. Aside from us.
It was really upsetting. I've never had an animal do that before.
Maybe there was something fiendish about this one.
I guess I have to be careful. Let's not throw that word around willy-nilly now.
All it something, had to do was...
devilish, you might say.
No, can't use that one either.
Ooh, how about conniving?
All right, sure.
Mephistophelian.
Damn.
All I had to do was ask for food, and I would have helped it.
Oh. Seems like this is an evening of firsts.
Well, thankfully, due to everyone's contributions, reluctantly nod in Squeak's direction, I think we're strong enough to continue on with our mission, and we shouldn't lose sight of it.
All right, we had an actual proper trail. So we should get back to that, and... yeah. Keep moving. So that's okay with everyone. The night is young.
All right. Let's go.
You're going back to the trail that... whoop! I blinded myself.
As we leave, Pontifex is going to pluck like one of the larger wing feathers that he can from the corpse.
Yeah.
It's like the biggest wing feather that he can find, so probably towards like the tips of the wings.
Mm-hmm. You have a hawk bear feather.
Hawk bear!
Talix probably would have collected one too, just because...
perfect.
Even if it feels a little weird taking one from a dead animal.
The pearl was the first part of the puzzle. The feather is the second part.
100%. I don't think... Did Brooke actually say that?
No, that was me.
Okay.
Oh.
All right. Talix sort of given you a spiel about the difference between collecting for money and collecting for science.
Sure.
So you're returning to the trail you originally had, right? Just before you split up. Okay. I'm going to need a survival roll from whoever is following it, if it's still Pip.
Pip's not doing it anymore.
I can take the lead.
Yeah, okay.
I haven't been hurt.
Stalix can do a survival roll, and I'm going to need also... actually, let me just check. I guess I'm not going to need it. Okay.
Yes!
Oh!
There it is.
We were once again out of balance.
Not for long.
All right.
Holy crap, your nat 20 and nat 1 counters are astronomical.
It's all I roll.
That's crazy.
What is Sid's secret?
Don't pay attention to it.
He's so cool.
He is.
Yeah, just
so cool.
Be super cool.
Exfoliate.
Cool
Okay. Talix, you follow the trail that you guys have abandoned a little bit earlier. This one is actually kind of easy to follow because of just how much damage in the surroundings this animal must have done as it comes through. And you follow the trail for a few minutes, but like the further you go, the more you begin to slow down, Talix. And there finally comes a moment that kind of confirms your suspicions when you spot this large footprint in the ground that is very very well preserved. It's very you can see the shape incredibly well, And then you're sure that the trail that you're currently following, the last one that Pip had, does not belong to a wolf. This footprint is very much that of a bear.
Well, bad news. I think we've been following the trail for the creature we've already found. Or is it a... Would I know that it's a different bear with my 25?
It is exactly... you just examined and sketched one. You are pretty certain that it's exactly the same kind of bear. You can't tell if it's the same individual, but there is no doubt in your mind that it's most definitely a hulk bear. Perhaps the clue doesn't really come from the footprint, but eventually you did spot like a feather that was stuck in the branches that matches the one you collected.
Unless you think there's any conceivable way these farmers would have construed that as the wolf creature that was described to us.
It's unlikely. But let us not focus on the negatives. As always, we should focus on the positives. We may not have dealt with the threat in question, but this was a creature that would intelligently lure others, other sentient creatures out to their death. This, perhaps some of the any deaths that might have been blamed on the wolf creature might have actually been claimed by this. We may have done the town a bigger service than they realize.
Gara said, I also think that we should go back in case a wolf creature has used the time to snatch one of the animals. And unless we find a different trail, wait for it there for now.
Yeah, at this point, I think that's the best course of action. I agree.
And if it follows traditional wolves, they are most active at dusk and dawn. So perhaps we'll see activity later into the night. Maybe a breather would be best.
So we take a rest outside, put up our camp, and have one person keeping watch.
Shouldn't we get back to the farms first in case there's an attack?
Oh yeah, I meant obviously at the farms.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Stake out around the area.
Sure. Of course, if you all wish to pursue this through the night, that is of course also an option, but if we are willing, then perhaps watching the wolves' known hunting grounds would be a better option.
Do you think we'd be able to cover more ground if we were in two groups?
The saying is divide and conquer, but thus far it was divide and get mauled by a hawkbear.
Okay, well, in this case, we would specifically just be watching and listening the surrounding area for the wolf, for any sound of commotion. And we would message the others before any move was made into the, where the commotion was. So we try to get as much of a view of the full breadth of the farms that we can. And if anyone hears anything, we get grouped together and then go as a group.
Oh, wait. I have an idea.
What is your idea, Pip?
These things like to drag away big animals, right? We've got one right here. We could maybe use it to lure some.
We could try. It's not a guarantee that they'd eat this, but maybe so.
If they do, there's a surprise in it for them.
Oh, jeez.
Okay. What are you doing with the body?
course, that's a long way to drag it. I'm gonna drag it all the way back to the farms.
Professor, use your draggy thing.
I could. It would be no issue.
Alright, I can help putting it onto it.
Yeah, I'll assist.
It will take me about 10 minutes or so.
The disc can lift up to 500 pounds, is that right?
Correct.
Okay. Average bear high weight.
I feel like if it can fly, it has like hollow bones or something.
Right.
It does, yeah.
Wait. I'm just Googling. Can owlbears fly?
Hawk bear.
Owlbears don't have wings. Yeah, hawk bear, yeah.
They can fly?
I thought they'd be like penguins.
It swooped down on us and we took its feathers.
Yeah, how else?
It doesn't really make a lot of sense. It
can't be that heavy then.
Yeah, well, I was Googling it, okay? I wanted to see.
Yeah, just the concept of a flying bear.
On average, a normal bear will be between 350 and 550 pounds. So, like, if we take that and it's, like, lighter than that because it can also fly, then easily it can easily, be brought on the disc.
Well, he will do that, and he will summon his floating disc. A circular horizontal plane of force that is only 3 feet in diameter. So I think it's like kind of drooping off the sides, maybe dragging a little bit. That's okay. And it floats 3 feet above the ground, so you're gonna have to heft it 3 feet up.
Yeah, with all of you working together and Brooke doing most of the work, the bear can be lifted onto the disc and then effortlessly brought with you.
I guess Pip can, technically just shove this huge mass of meat 5 feet at a time.
Only if it's a creature.
Oh, if it's only dead,
it's an object.
It's an object.
D&D rules.
Is there really no, are you guys disconnecting from the DS? Are you okay?
I don't know what's happening, but yeah.
Wait, what does it say I have disconnected?
Well, I'm asking you!
Because you did.
I don't know the reason, it just disconnected me.
I did disconnect.
Yeah.
What is it with your server?
The Europeans.
Yeah, it could be European Steam servers, I suppose.
It just wanted me to listen to the TTS music.
Either way, I feel like I was answering someone's question.
Would you rather fight 100 bears or 100 hawk-sized bears or one bear-sized hawk?
Based on action economy, the bear-sized hawk.
Definitely a single one, yeah.
We've learned from the 8 panthers.
Anyways. I think we were pretty much set, right?
So, Talix is the one leading the way, who seems to currently have the best idea of where you guys roughly are. And you guys follow him. You've been wandering for maybe 2 to 3 hours. A little hard to say for how long you've been out here. But, Talix, you feel like you're roughly about halfway back to towards the of the distance that you've covered so far, when all of you can hear howling, that is just very recognizable as a wolf howling. Although, Pip, you've heard wolves in the past, and this is the first time where, even though you're hearing the howl and you recognize it as definitely the howl of a wolf, you do not understand it. You have no idea what it is, what it means.
Ooh.
We're going to end the session here.
Alright.
Well, maybe Pontifex summons something. Maybe someone's creating or summoning weird wolves. Or it's a robot.
It's a jewel wolf.
Say, maybe it's actually a mechanical wolf that's covered in gems there or something to power it. I don't know. Gnome stuff.
It was dark. It could be. Oh, I'm excited!
Yeah. That was fun.
Yeah, great session.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the howling compared to you guys was behind you, so like not towards the farms. I don't know if that's going to change anything, but you can discuss this.
Immediately behind us.
not that close. I don't know.
Are we getting swooped again?
It was Pip.
It's Squeak messing with us.
this was a good session for Squeak to start the recap on.
Oh yeah.
That's true.
His identity has been ousted.
I'm gonna have to get my pet imp for the next one.
Yeah, if only that happened one session early, we would have seen the pet imp. Well, I'm glad you guys could be here for this. We'll have to see when we can play the next session. It's probably not going to be on Sunday, because we would be missing two players. But we're going to discuss this on our own during the week. And for now on, I'm happy I could have you for this. I hope you had a ton of fun, because I did.
Definitely did.
Yeah. I will see you again soon.
If there's a scheduling thing, like a conflict that happens, I'm totally willing to pass on a session for the sake of Talix being there, because him doing the recap is relatively important.
Oh yeah, he's doing the recap next week.
I think we're all relatively schedule malleable to, you know, miss someone for the sake of at least the recapper being there.
I wish I could be more malleable.
Yeah.
Aww.
Oh, we'll figure it out. Thank you for being your wonderful selves. I'll see you again very soon.
I will see you all next time.
Bye!
Bye, everyone. Bye. Thank you so much.